started as an idea.
I have a dream.
Then the people got behind it.
United, there is little we cannot do.
Now we can all live the dream.
It's Whip 'em Out Wednesday!
Keeping the dream alive. This is the Opie and Anthony Show.
Happy with her large boobs.
I bet.
Wednesday, woohoo!
Oh, you're very naughty.
Yes.
So addicted to boobies.
Yeah. And welcome to the Opie and Anthony Show.
Hello.
We got to get right into this today, Ant. Couple phone numbers in the New York area, 877-692-1027. Anywhere else, including...
Oh, my God. Can we do a triple?
Boston, Cleveland, and D.C.
Yes.
Phone number for you, 866-277-4WOW, 866-277-4WOW for those cities and everyone else outside of New York.
Man, oh, man.
Let me go to Cheryl. She's very pissed off right off the bat. Cheryl, what's wrong?
What did we do?
You guys.
What's
what?
Up? What, Cheryl?
I'm upset with the both of you.
With the both of you.
Okay.
Because you weren't at work yesterday, and, you know, you had me waiting. I count down the hours until 3 o'clock every day.
Yeah. Yep.
And then at 3 o'clock, never heard you guys.
Who are you? I ain't calling you, lady.
Guys, when did you say something the day before?
Well,
how disappointed I was.
Aw, see how people get disappointed when we're not here.
That's kind
like
of
like I'm waiting on this delicious meal. I count on the hours. I count on the hours.
Hey, we had a pretty good streak going. 4 weeks without taking a day off.
But you should have. Then I heard the thing with Keith the cop. So I said, okay, fine.
Yeah.
It was a good thing for me replaying it.
Yeah. Well, we had it.
Then I heard, oh, we're going to take a break. Oh, so I said, okay, fine. They'll be on after the break.
I got to be honest. I had a scam going, and everyone caught me on it.
Yeah, because you weren't going to the Islanders game, right? I know.
Even Cheryl knows.
I know if you weren't at work, you wouldn't reach to the game on time.
Hey, I planted the seed like last week. I'm like, guys, you know, I'm going to the dentist, and I don't do well with the dentist, and it's a little more than a cavity this time around.
Right.
So I don't know. I don't know if I'm going to be up for working. And finally someone, read the sports section of the paper and went, wait a minute. My Islanders, I mean, first playoff home game in, I think, 8 years.
Right.
I had to be there.
I know. I said, you know what? I want him to lose because he didn't turn up.
Well, they won.
Yeah, I know.
They kicked ass last night.
Don't take off any more days for the rest of the year.
Perfect game, by the way. We just killed the Maple Leafs, 6-1.
Yeah,
end of the game, a nice huge fight right in front of us.
Nice.
Oh, man. I couldn't be happier. But I was using the...
How did little Gary like the game, Opie? Little 12-year-old Gary, did he enjoy the game?
Hey, man, I had to bring my brother.
Oh, you didn't take him. That's right. Oh, okay.
My brother's a big Islander fan.
Yeah.
So I had to bring him in.
You can take him to a playoff game.
Playoffs.
No more days, okay?
All right.
No more days.
Somebody was saying, Cheryl, how come you couldn't predict that we weren't going to be in?
You know something? I was saying, I know Oak would not be coming because I know Islanders playing. I know he's not going to be
here. Wow, so you do have some magical powers. You're just like Miss Cleo.
I'm seeing in the cards that Opie's not going to be in. I'm seeing in the sports section. The sports section.
Don't disappoint me again because I count down the hours every day just to hear you guys.
You got it, Cheryl.
Okay.
All right.
Okay, bye. I love you guys.
It's nice to be loved. Thanks,
okay,
Cheryl.
Bye.
Yes.
All right.
And the love just shining through in multiple cities, Opie. Multiple cities.
Stan from Hoboken. It's great to see syndication hasn't changed you guys. You're still lazy F's. Dude, man, we went 4 weeks without taking a day off.
Look at Dan, you bastard.
I know there's a faithful listener out there that could figure out the longest we've gone without taking a day off. 4 weeks is about our limit.
Is that it?
That's about our limit, Anthony.
I know there was a stretch where we went months without a day off. I am sure of it.
I don't know, man.
It was ridiculous.
Ridiculous.
Well, we missed a great day yesterday.
Yes.
Ratings are coming in from all over the place for the Opie and Anthony radio show, Anthony.
Uh-huh.
Since we last talked, the ratings came in for D.C.,
mm-hmm.
Cleveland, and Boston.
Right.
And Boston.
Yeah, I was very, very happy to see the ratings in Boston.
And,
oh, gosh.
I think we're going to start today with the ratings for Boston.
Hey, guys.
Yes, Rockhole.
Could you help me out? I was really counting on my ratings bonus. So I need a couple of bucks because it seems I'm not going to be getting one this book.
Seems like you're never going to get another ratings bonus,
guys,
Rockhole.
Dave, what did you do to me? I wanted to fight these guys.
Yeah, see the Dave Douglas strategy of not talking about this show and not acknowledging the
make him believe we didn't exist.
Yeah, yeah. And then when we talk about your fake radio, you don't try to defend it.
It all paid off for you guys at AAF. We're going to give you some news that AAF will not be giving their listeners, Anthony.
Right.
But I figure before we start telling you the ratings of Boston,
yeah,
that we do a little, what would you call it, Anthony? A retrospective?
Like a little retrospective.
It's something we like to call the Opie and Anthony timeline.
It was very, very important for us to get back into Boston, wasn't it?
Oh, hell yeah. Everyone knows that.
And
our loyal following here in New York understood.
Give the people that turn their backs on Opie and Anthony their just desserts.
That's right.
Right.
So Ann and I sat down and we put some thoughts together and we came up with the Opie and Anthony timeline.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of a little story about your pals, Opie and Anthony.
Right.
Where it began. And up to the present day, which is
present day.
The release of the winter ratings in Boston.
Yes.
So we're going to start from the beginning, Anthony. This will be a lot of fun
mm-hmm.
as we look back and reflect.
Let us reflect
on the events that got us to today. Right? So we start our timeline, the Opie and Anthony timeline.
Mm-hmm.
With August 1994.
Wow, we got to go all the way back to August of 94 for this?
Don't worry, we'll be fast-forwarding with this timeline.
Wow.
But we got to start from the beginning, August 1994.
Oh, sorry, I was having a flashback that I actually had to work for a living.
Well, you were...
Oh, Jesus, that was scary.
You were doing the air conditioner thing, Anthony.
I was.
So let me just read what I got for the Opie and Anthony timeline for August 1994.
August 94. This is almost like a special.
They
put together on for TV.
Yeah. It's written here. While doing nights at WBAB on Long Island.
Yeah.
Opie meets Anthony.
Oh-ho!
The air conditioner installer.
Yes. And it was love at first. Yes, I was installing ductwork.
That's right.
For the wonderful folks at Apollo Air Conditioning in Bayshore.
What is that, Rick?
Well, I guess Rick has a little taste of what it was like for Opie pre-Anthony, I guess this is, right?
Yep. B.A.B., who's this?
Wow. I really don't know what that is, Anthony.
Wow, I don't know what that is either.
I have no clue.
I think we have a regular straight... Opie played music. He was a music jock.
Look, man, I'll be the first to admit that I try to do radio the right way.
The right way?
Well, the way they taught me in college.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there
okay.
Here we go.
Get a load of this, Norton.
WBAB, Long Island's home of rock and roll. It's Opie cruising through a 102-minute commercial-free Long Island marathon. Yeah. With Genesis, of course, Elvis Costello, Veronica, Queen, B-52s, but some of that good stuff, and the boss in there as well.
The boss? Oh, that's Springsteen.
Jimmy, that's like almost 10 years ago.
Isn't it funny now when you mention the boss, usually Scumbag is right after it or
yeah,
before
exactly.
It.
Exactly. Exactly.
Oh, my God. Let me let that settle in a bit.
Hey, man, like I said, I'll admit I used to try to do radio the way they taught me, and then I realized it was
It was a bunch of crap.
Were you cruising through it, like you said?
I was rocking and cruising.
We're cruising through. And what did you call it? A Long Island Music Marathon?
And I do believe I was also rolling.
Right.
That's not all. Come, help me out, Ann. That's not the only thing I did.
I understand. You don't have to sell me.
I got my bits in there.
I know. It's just it was a, you know, BAB was a music station. And, you know, you played music.
It's called the back cell.
Right, the back cell, where you tell everybody the songs and artists they just heard.
Let me tell you something.
Veronica.
Veronica. Sometime this summer, I am bringing the first show you and I did together.
Yeah.
And I'll play that. Mm-hmm. There's plenty of embarrassing moments on that tape, Anthony.
Yes.
All right, so the Opie and Anthony timeline. August 1994, while doing nights at BAB on Long Island, Opie meets Anthony, the air conditioner installer, after his band Rotgut submits the song Gun Electric Shock OJ.
Right, I remember it like it was 2,000 years ago.
Into the OJ song parody contest that I had
yes.
running.
Yes.
See, I was doing a bit, Anthony.
I see.
All right.
Right in between Veronica and the boss. There was a song contest, and people had to send in their song parodies about the O.J. Simpson trial.
That's right.
Situation.
Opie thinks to himself, this is my first impression of Anthony.
Mm-hmm.
He may look a bit strange with the big 70s afro, but boy, is he talented. Anthony used to wear his hair. Like,
well, I was in the band Rotgut,
right.
as you know, and... We were very, I don't know, very colorful on stage, I guess you could say. And I used to totally puff my hair out. And the bigger, the better.
Right.
So it was just completely out of control.
We want to play the song that got us together here.
Yeah. Here it is.
By Rotgut.
Right.
Anthony's singing along here.
Right. Me and Joe. Brother Joe. That's...
In Los Angeles jail, and the judge won't let me post my bail. Now this could be the end of me, 'cause California's got that death penalty. They call an electric shock, OJ, cook my behind like a chicken croquet. Got an electric shock, OJ, toast my behind. Nicole, I really loved that girl, but she had the worst luck in the world. I was only cleaning my knife, I accidentally stabbed her 36 times. Gone electric shock, OJ, cook my behind like that cherry flambé. Ooh, gone electric shock, OJ, roast my behind. Looks like I'm a guilty man. Love lots of women. Now I'm gonna have to love my hand. Lawyers argue over my head, why they be warming up that electrical chair. They call the electric shock, OJ, hook my behind like a flabby fillet. They call the electric shock, OJ, rose my behind. Electric
shot.
There you go.
O.J.
There you have it.
There you go.
That was the song responsible for me being here today.
That's right. That song is
That's
now
it.
8 years old, Anthony.
Right.
Brother Joe wants in on this. Yes, Joe.
Hey, fellas.
Hey, Joe was playing the music on that one, by the way. Joe playing the music on that one. Thank
That's
you.
That's right, and Anthony writing the words. I remember that was a very, he made that a very clear point.
During
when,
litigations.
when we did the Aerosmith after party.
Right.
At
Eastside Comedy Club. Yeah.
Right?
Yes, Joe.
No, but I called in to say that to get that tape to Opie, I mean directly into Opie's hands, because me and Anthony had done a couple of parodies before that.
Yeah.
And submitted it to various radio shows. But in order to get it into Opie's hands, I stood at the back door of BAB for like 45 minutes waiting
banging
for
on the door.
Waiting for this shady character, Opie, that we only knew by voice, and arguing with Doug Yoel.
Doug Yoel!
Yeah. He wanted to take the tape and, oh, yeah, yeah, I'll give it to Opie. I was like, no, I want Opie at the back door now.
Oh, thank God he took the tape. Oh, my God, thank God he took the tape. I'd have been in an attic right now as we speak with a screw gun, and snips in my hand.
No, yes, I would have gotten you a position in the shop, no problem.
Thanks, bastard. All right, Joe. Cool, man.
All right, fellas, I'm listening to your timeline.
Cool, thank you.
Yes. Right,
if you're just tuning in, we're doing the Opie and Anthony timeline that is going to end with the ratings that came out for Boston yesterday, Anthony.
Yes.
So, yeah, Anthony and his band submitted that song, and then
Dan from Hoboken wants to know if Brother Joe's working on Gun Electric Shock Robert Blake.
Not a bad idea. And then we kind of decided, hey, man, you know, we get along, we got a chemistry, we're going to try to do some
radio. Yeah, it was working, right.
What is left in this timeline for August 1994? Anthony gets kicked in the nuts by a goat.
Right.
And Opie has the goat relieve itself into the morning man's coffee cup.
Hey, good morning to you. How you doing?
Oh, that's the God's honest truth. And soon after, Opie and Anthony have the pancake summit at IHOP.
The pancake summit.
And decide to do a radio show together.
Right.
Hey, it's Bob Buckman in the morning here, B.A.B. My coffee tastes a little weird today. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's just the morning or something. The coffee tastes a little off this morning. Oh.
Really fast, we had this guy bring a goat down, and the goat proceeded to take a dump.
Yeah.
All over the studio, little pellets bouncing around all over the place.
Uh-huh.
And then the goat decides, because, I mean, he looked scary with the big afro, decided that, I don't know, Anthony was a threat, so decided to head him in the ballies.
Well, yeah, you know how goats can be. So he, reared up and got me right in the crotch.
And then the goat, I could tell, wanted to relieve himself, so I took the morning guy's coffee cup. Considering the guy was playing all my stuff during the morning show and not giving me any credit, I was a little pissed off. And I let the goat relieve itself in the
started relieving itself on the rug.
Mm-hmm.
And Opie goes, uh-oh, and grabbed the coffee cup and put it under the goat and let him fill it up. What left the what left the worst taste in Bob Buckman's mouth? That cup of coffee I happen to work with a radio check here in New York. I don't know.
And then we went to the IHOP and said, hey, man, I told Ann, hey, man, give me, you know, just give me some time and I'll find us a gig somewhere.
Right.
And
you know, because I wasn't quite sure, you know, I thought, here we go. It's a goof. I go in there a couple of nights a week. But, you know, I have my day job. I got to pay the rent. You know, nigga got to eat. So, you know, I wasn't ready to just, you know, throw that great career away in tin knocking to chase the dream, as they say, Opie. Chase the dream.
Mm-hmm.
But it worked out at the Pancake Summit.
Yeah.
And we decided that's it. Okay, let's get something working.
So, moving along, Anthony.
I have a question. So you decided that you wanted to do a show at Ant, and you took him out for pancakes.
Dude, I wasn't. We weren't making any money.
No. What I'm saying is,
I was trying to figure out how I'm going to pay for the Pancake Summit.
Are you nodding and listening to him as he's going through the whole spiel about being on the radio and thinking to yourself, like, you're trying to play casual, like, uh-huh. Yeah, that sounds really good. And you're like,
oh yeah, I was just like, uh-uh. Oh my God, I'm like, get out of here. Oh, this would be great. I had been, been a huge fan of radio. Wanted to try to get into it for many years, but you know, just ask the people at John Glenn High School out there on Long Island. I wasn't very motivated as far as schooling goes, so it's kind of hard to just knock on a radio station door and get a gig. So I had Joe knock on the door, and he got me the gig.
All right, so the Opie and Anthony timeline. This is the timeline
that's
going to finish with the ratings that came out yesterday for Boston, Anthony. And we're gonna fast forward. Don't worry, you'll see.
Oh, yeah.
February 1995. Opie and Anthony have been doing radio less than 6 months.
Uh-huh.
That's at BAB. When they're plucked from obscurity by then-program director of WAAF, The Great. Ron Valeri. Let it be known, the guy that hired us to go to Boston, Ron Valeri, Anthony. Key to the story.
What a guy.
Ron discovers the boys while taking a trip to Long Island and hires them to do afternoon drive at WAF, a rock station out of Worcester, Mass.
Yeah.
All right?
I so remember that. The first real quit your day job radio gig for Ant. Ah, yeah. Because working with Opie, I think I remember being cut a check by BAB, which I still have somewhere, for
$25.
$25. For my week's work.
Yeah?
He ain't lying.
Man. I'm not lying.
He ain't lying.
What was I going to do, complain?
It didn't come from me, though.
I know.
Bob cut that check.
Now, right. You know, let me sign this here. This coffee tastes awful.
Yeah, there's something no one heard about before.
Right. But, yeah, I think I saved it as my first real radio job paycheck.
Right. Right.
Never cashed it.
So February 1995, we're plucked from obscurity, and we're moving to Mass, Anthony. Opie goes to Anthony's apartment still February 1995.
Oh, can I step in? I'm sorry.
Yeah.
This junk mail Jerry says that right now Rockhole and Dave Dickless are plotting some scheme where they go back in time and kill my brother before he could give you the tape.
Oh, it's going to end with Rockhole and Dickless, trust me.
Rockhole, you'll have to go back to the future.
Right. February 1995, it continues. Opie goes to Anthony's apartment to prepare for the move to Boston.
Yes.
And realizes that he doesn't own a car.
Well, Opie, I wasn't making much money knocking a tin, being a sheet metal worker. And Apollo Air Conditioning had given me a van, a company van, which I was only supposed to use during company hours.
Right.
As I backed my jet ski into half-broken the water in there, off the Apollo van.
Right.
Yes.
It continues, unless you count the 1986 Dodge K car
that's
in the middle of the weeds sitting on four concrete blocks with no wheels.
Yeah, yeah. That was given to me by my sister.
You pointed to that car and go, no, I got a car. I'm taking that to Massachusetts.
Well, that'll get me to Mass. Of course it will.
Didn't even have plates, Anthony.
I was working on that.
And then I
was so broke.
I finished this timeline by saying, at this point, Opie wonders what he got himself into.
It's true. Come on, I was very broke.
Anyway, Opie and Anthony head to Massachusetts.
Oh, what? I'm not going to be able to enlighten the crowd on the Opie is not getting a moving van story?
Oh, you could do that.
Jesus Christ.
You could do that. I didn't have many things.
Boom!
I didn't have much
stuff. That's what he told me. Here we go. We're getting a U-Haul, right? I got to get a U-Haul to move my stuff. So I get a U-Haul. Opie goes, look, instead of me getting a moving van, save a little space on the back of the U-Haul. Because I don't need much room. I don't have much of anything. I'm leaving a lot of stuff here. I go, okay. So I worked on packing this thing like a puzzle where I had taken up all the room possible and left on the back
2 feet tops.
No, I would say 3 to 4 feet.
Wow.
On the back
Thank
of the
you.
Truck.
But thank you. It was like an 18-foot U-Haul.
That's all I could spare.
Thank you. Thank you.
And you told me last minute that you weren't going to get a truck, that you were going to use mine. I'd have gotten a longer truck.
You had a lot of stuff.
So I
for having
pulled
no
in
money,
there.
Man.
Yeah, I had no money, but I rented the goddamn Ryder truck.
Just a bunch of crap.
I pulled up to your house, and Opie wound up having to throw away half of his stuff.
I just broke it in the road. I said, all right, what the hell? I did what I could, and I left everything else behind.
I couldn't imagine.
I had a fine apartment in Northport.
Why you didn't get your own U-Haul?
I was lazy like yourself, dude.
All right.
Anyway, so we head to Massachusetts.
Right, look at us going. There it is, 95.
Opie and Anthony move into 91. Anthony's ex-mother-in-law's house. and start doing their afternoon radio show.
Not from the house, from the station.
AAF, right.
On the highway.
Little side note, Opie doesn't move out until 18 months later.
18 months later. Opie lived with my mother-in-law. My ex-mother-in-law for 18 months.
No, don't do the universal fist, like, thrusting forward movement for sex. No, I have no idea why, again, Opie decided to stay, because I was out of there with the wife in, no, it was a matter of weeks.
Because, maybe a month then.
Because, you know, the ex-wife couldn't take living there with her mom. So she was like, we're getting out of here, lickety-split. But Opie decided to stay for 18 months. He lived with my mother-in-law at the time. Yeah. And let us not... Yeah, let me enlighten you on a little something, too. This got brought up in court. In court, during my divorce.
Born to be wild.
Born to be living with my mother-in-law. Here's some of the questioning from famed attorney Dominic Barber during my trial.
Is it true that your on-air partner, Opie, lived with your mother-in-law for 18 months?
All of a sudden, now it's going to cost me money.
Right.
They're going to try to swing it that the reason that we're so successful is for some reason Opie stayed with my mother-in-law for 18 months.
Because she supported us.
Right.
Right? Some kind of support thing there?
Oh, my God.
Opie, do you want some breakfast? I'll cook for you.
Tell Jim about how I broke everything in the house.
Yeah, and then he broke, like, she got little things all over her house, like everyone has, a little ceramic, little tchotchkes.
Knick-knack and bric-a-brac.
Hummels and whatnot. And she had a phone cord that was like 3 miles long. And that's one of the ways Opie would break everything. He'd pick up the phone and go walking around the house with it because he can't stay still. And the cord is just knocking stuff off of shelves and little tables. And you would drop things. You broke stuff in the bathroom. All these little, you know, oh, there goes the horn off of my unicorn.
But thank God I love Opie.
How did she know you had left the bedroom? Did you put the thing back on the table backwards?
All of a sudden, when you finally decided to leave,
yeah,
she was very alone.
Yeah.
And then after I got my divorce, or started getting a divorce from my wife, when she wasn't going to be my mother-in-law anymore, she had that big poster up in her house.
Of us.
Of us from the Demented World poster.
Yeah.
And she loved Opie so much, she didn't want to get rid of the poster, so she cut it in half. So she only had Opie. Don't want that picture of me up in the house.
Yeah.
18 months.
Yeah.
She made quite an impression on the old crone.
All right. Moving along, Anthony, with the Opie and Anthony timeline. It ends with the ratings that came out yesterday for Boston.
But
it's a little brief history of some of the things we went through.
Yeah.
And it's going to start moving forward fast here. March 1995.
March 95, yes.
After being at WAAF for only 2 weeks.
Uh-huh.
2 weeks.
Two.
The man who discovered us on Long Island leaves AAF to go to New York for a much better gig.
Right.
He tells us how good the show sounds as he's packing his boxes in his office.
Yeah, he was like, oh, okay, great. Great job. Goodbye. You guys sound great.
Bye.
Gotta pack, gotta go. Goodbye. Like, he was off to another gig.
Another gig.
And we were all excited. You know something? I got to explain this. When we went to AAF back then, Opie, because I knew nothing about radio, so Opie enlightens me like, oh, my God, this guy Ron Valeri is the boss. This guy is going to be great to work under. We're going to be able to do a lot of the stuff we want to do without a lot of pain in the ass management getting in the way, because this guy understands the type of show we do. I mean, you could not say anything more about Ron Valeri.
He got us, and he got the show.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, he's now out of radio, and he's one of the best.
Yeah, so...
But radio claims another victim, I mean. So yeah. He moved on to other things. He can't take it anymore, this crap.
So Opie, very excited about this. And I'm like, wow, this is really cool. Great. He's there for a matter of weeks. Not even.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
Yeah, gotta go. Goodbye. And he left. You know, he went off to a better job. What's he going to do? But we didn't know this when we got hired that he was going to leave.
Right. And who
so he's
is his replacement?
He's packing his boxes in his office as he's telling us how great the show sounds. He will be missed. Yeah. Opie and Anthony have no idea their nightmare is about to begin.
Yeah.
Soon after Ron Valeri leaves, AF hires...
Yes.
Dave Douglas from Nebraska.
There you go, because that's the kind of market you want to delve into to get a great, great program director for a major East Coast city. You want to go to Nebraska and find a program director. Nebraska! Dave Dickless,
better known as, right, Dave Dickless, the amoeba, the man without a backbone.
The man without a spine.
Douglas is hired to be technically our boss.
Right.
The program director at AAF. Stop.
Ugh.
April 1995, then we're going to have to take a break here and continue. Less than 1 month later, Anthony.
Yeah.
So we've barely been up there in Massachusetts. Opie realizes Dave Dickless is clueless and can never be trusted. When he corners Opie near the coffee machine, this is another story we've never told.
Yeah, this is great. This made me really, really like Dave Dick Douche.
So he corners me near the coffee machine. This is a little over a month being up in Massachusetts, and asks why I teamed up with Anthony. He didn't get it. He didn't understand.
You know why? Because I hadn't done radio. And in Nebraska, apparently, the only way you can ever get into radio is if you've had as much schooling and whatnot as a Dave Dickless. You know, perish the thought that Opie saw somebody that maybe had some raw talent and wants to bring him on the show. Whatever. Or any radio show, for that matter. Find somebody that has raw talent or an appreciation for radio and just wants to get in it. Dave couldn't imagine that, couldn't fathom it. He'd rather you maybe fly a plane over Fenway.
Right.
And pick a seat number and pick your sidekick that way.
Well, douchebag. And at this point, Anthony was doing radio less than a year. And how the business goes, you know, you got to hire someone with a bunch of radio station call letters.
Right.
Next to their
You're
resume.
Paying for it now, aren't you, scumbag? You're paying. Look at the book, Dave. It's awful. God, I can't stand that.
So, April 1995, Opie realizes Dave Dickless is clueless and can never be trusted when he corners Opie near the coffee machine and asks why he teamed up with Anthony. I answer, because he probably is the funniest man in radio today, you douche.
Thank you, Opie.
You're welcome, my friend. I tell Dave to F off and go program music. Oh, yeah, right from the start, we weren't scared of this guy. After this exchange, Dave becomes a non-entity in Opie and Anthony's radio career.
Non-entity.
That would be a non-entity.
Mm-hmm.
Opie and Anthony start building a loyal and rabid following with their radio show, putting AAF on the map. No thanks to Dave Dickless and the rest of the management at the station, who seem to not understand the toxic twins.
Yes.
Right now, a little audio of our old boss.
Ah.
Dave Dickless.
Dave Dickless.
Continue the Opie and Anthony timeline.
Enjoy.
He was always calling and harassing us and bothering us.
And telling us things we shouldn't be talking about on the air.
Right. Here's one of those phone calls.
Hello.
Hello.
What's up?
I just wanted to...
Why are you on this line?
Well, I figured it was easier than getting out of my chair and coming down the hall.
Oh.
Just wanted to make a request.
Yeah.
Maybe we could steer the show in a little different direction so that this doesn't get out of hand.
What's getting out of hand?
Well, I think we're going into the gay zone, and we all know where that leads. Wouldn't you agree?
Not really, but...
Hokey pokey in the butt?
No.
Licky licky?
That's fun stuff.
Yeah, it's fun, but you know what? It's going to get us in trouble. Just, you know, steer somewhere else. If you keep going this direction, it's going to be trouble. I'm just warning you. Not from me. I'm talking about outside. We've been down this road before.
The old dirt road.
Yeah. Just giving you a little heads up here.
All right.
Okay.
Head.
See you.
Uh-huh.
Hello. Going into the gay zone. We're going into the gay zone. We're going into the gay zone. Just wanted to, hokey pokey in the butt. Yeah. Hokey pokey in the butt.
Oh.
Gay zone. Hokey pokey in the butt. Yeah. Hokey pokey in the butt.
Oh.
Licky, 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 licky.
Licky.
The old dirt road.
What you doing? Yeah. Licky, licky.
The old dirt road.
Licky, licky.
The old dirt road.
Hokey pokey in the butt. Yeah. Fun.
Going into the gay zone.
Yeah. Going into the gay zone.
Not really.
Going into the gay zone. What
hokey pokey in the butt.
Yeah. Hokey pokey in the butt. Yeah. Gay zone. Hokey pokey in the butt. Hokey pokey. In the butt, licky, 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 lick, lick, licky, pokey, pokey in the butt, yeah.
Licky, licky,
yeah, it's fun. Licky, licky, yeah, it's fun. Pokey, pokey in the butt.
Da, da, da. Not really.
Da, da, da. Da, da, Dave. Oh, I love what this is all leading up to. I love it.
Yeah, we're going to have to take a break, but we're doing the Opie and Anthony timeline. It ends with... What went on in Boston yesterday, Anthony?
Oh, yes.
The ratings came out in Boston yesterday. And we got some great news, but we figured we kind of relive this whole Opie and Anthony thing.
I think it makes it a little clear why it's so important to us.
Yes.
To go back and just rip the a-holes out of you.
Right. So the timeline will continue after this quick break with May 1995. Opie and Anthony invent...
Wow.
Listen to me very carefully.
Rip 'em out Wednesday.
The Opie and Anthony Show.
Yeah, you're checking out the Opie and Anthony Show. We're reliving some career highlights. Bear with us today.
All based on the fact that the Boston rating came out yesterday and... That's what we're leading up to.
That's right. We're doing the Opie and Anthony timeline. Yes, we know we're gloating today. Trust me, we're not stupid.
But I think anybody that's a fan of this show would realize how important it is to us to, and it was important to get up into Boston in the first place, back up there again, and to kick some ass. That's it. It's very important. And if you're a fan of this show, I think you realize that.
All right, so we're doing the Opie and Anthony timeline. I left off with April 1995, Anthony. It'll move forward fast. Opie and Anthony start building a loyal and rabid following with their radio show, putting WAAF on the map.
Yeah.
It needs to be said, before we came to Massachusetts, none of the other Boston stations paid attention to AF.
No, it was pretty much a station that was relegated to the Worcester market. Worcester, Massachusetts. You know? And one thing that Brucey Mittman said to us, he was the general manager at WAF when we got hired there. He said, boys, we're trying to get the station in the Boston market, not just Worcester. So if there's any conversations that mention cities or what you're doing that night, maybe going to see a band, make sure you're talking about Boston and not Worcester boys.
So it was.
We hate Worcester boys. Yeah, we don't want to be a Worcester station. We want to get into the Boston market and make an impact on the Boston.
So it was pretty much that was the point that AF made its turnaround to becoming a force to be reckoned with at the time.
Right.
In Boston.
So we put him on the map. No thanks to Dave Dickless and the rest of the management at the station.
Yeah.
Who seemed to not understand the Toxic Twins and what they were all about.
No thanks. Against the negative impact that son of a bitch had on our show. That guy knew nothing of what was going to make this show popular. And he did everything in his power to fight what we were trying to do. Have a little fun. Get up there and, you know, get on the air every day and have some fun with people. Get people involved with the show. The guy didn't understand. He was from Nebraska. Nebraska mentality. He knows how to pitchfork hay. That's it. You see the picture of him and his wife? He's standing next door with the pitchfork by the barn. That's him. That's him. You hillbilly.
You drink hillbilly.
All right, May 1995, Opie and Anthony invent WOW, the greatest radio promotion ever.
That goes down in, I don't know, history like the invention of the light bulb, Opie.
That's right.
And the automobile.
That's right.
Right. Wow. Huge.
Huge. Put wow in your car. If the girls feel like it, they'll flash on the way home. A quite simple concept.
Yeah.
That seemed to take off in Massachusetts, Anthony.
Yes, it did.
With homemade wow signs all over the highways because the station didn't want to support it, so we didn't get to do bumper stickers back then.
Who didn't want to see some boobage? And everyone put the wow in their vehicle.
Dave Dickless, Anthony.
Dave Dickless, again, taking something that is instant publicity. People like doing it. It's not something you got to force down people's throats. This is a fun thing. A fun thing that made our show more popular. And what did Dave say? Stop doing it. They don't do this in Nebraska. Stop.
So with wow and their innovative radio style... Hey, we're writing this in the third person.
So is wow in there.
Sounds like a special.
They make AAF the station to listen to in the Boston area. That is the God's honest truth.
Right.
Fast forward to May 1997. Everything is going pretty well for the boys as they continue to not listen to anyone and do what they feel like doing.
Exactly.
Following their intuition, Anthony.
If we would have listened to Dave Dickless... Just look at Rocco. Look at Rockhole right now. There you go. That's what would have happened to the show. Fake, lame radio.
The Opie and Anthony timeline continues with May 1997. It ends with the ratings that came out yesterday, so bear with us. Dave Dickless forces Opie and Anthony to stop doing wow.
That's right.
Proving again he has no backbone.
None.
And unfortunately, at the time, Ant and I didn't have that much power. We really had no choice in the matter.
A couple of groups of twats get together and send in some goddamn letters to Dave, and he buckles right under and says, stop doing it. It's called publicity. It's called, getting the name of the show out there.
Oh, stop that. Because it's all about me.
No, it isn't. Failure at that station's all about you, though, Dave. You can take credit for that. Ha-ha. Douchebag.
We stopped doing wow.
Yes.
May 1997, Anthony.
Mm-hmm. But not good enough.
Oh, no.
Because we got suspended.
Still doing okay. Getting suspended left and right. The real suspensions, not the fake.
Hey.
And April 1st, 1998 comes about.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Opie calls Anthony.
I remember this like it was yesterday, yes.
And tells him his great idea for an April Fool's Day prank.
Great idea.
Let's tell our listeners that the mayor died in a car accident.
Right.
While vacationing in Florida. Mm-hmm. Opie doesn't notice that Anthony is barely awake when he says, okay.
Okay, sure. Sounds great. I'm going back to sleep.
Yeah. We go on the air. We do it.
Got some news.
Got some news.
Got some press out of it.
Pretty much know what happens from here on out. April 2nd, 1998.
Yeah.
The last time Dave Dickless talks to Opie and Anthony.
Right.
To this day.
That's it. It's over.
The last thing he ever said to us is, we are suspending you without pay.
Right.
And there will be an internal investigation. To this day, Dave Dickless has never talked to O&A again.
Nope.
Good. Good.
Yeah. Wait, what?
That's right.
With his Midwestern Nebraska mentality.
After all we did for AF, he decided to never talk to us again.
This is how the Dickless Dave works. This is how he operates. He'll try to use up anyone's resources to advance himself. And then if something happens, he will turn his back on you in a second. In a second. Look at Rockhole's old partner that he had. Was actually getting Rockhole that tool a couple of numbers. Was actually doing it. Dave Dickless had a little disagreement with him. And that's it. Gone. And Rockhole didn't even to argue the point with Dave. Paying for it now, aren't you? Paying for it. Pay. You'll pay until you're gone. That's right.
A sad day on April 9th, 1998, Anthony.
They stretched it out that long?
It was a week. the Opie and Anthony timeline. The boys are told to go to the Colonnade Hotel in Boston.
Yes, I remember.
On Huntington Avenue.
Uh-huh.
They sit across the 20-foot table from Don Belukis.
Yeah. Right. I remember this.
Better known as the Terminator.
The Terminator. Walking into the Colonnade, the discussion between me and Opie. Still, you think this is it? You think we're getting fired? And in hindsight, looking back, what else could we have thought? They're taking us to a hotel conference room to tell us that we have our jobs back? No! They're firing us. We go up there, Don Belukis,
the Terminator,
in such sensitive style, says, we're going to have to terminate your contract.
That's right, how I wrote it here. There's not a hint of humanity in this cyborg's bones. As he says, we're going to terminate your contracts.
Yeah. Terminate.
My first thought is that we're not insects.
Yeah. Terminate with extreme prejudice.
Right, we're not insects. Then it sinks in. After putting AAF on the map and making them an S-load of money, we're being tossed aside like a used whore.
Right.
We were fired!
Gone.
Yes.
You're fired.
Actual audio of Ant and I leaving the Colonnade.
We're tanks for nothing!
Tanks for nothing.
Tanks for nothing.
You're fired.
Yeah. Yeah, they gave us the boot.
We immediately drowned our sorrows at Daisy Buchanan's on Newbury Street.
Yeah.
And watched the news stations report on our demise, Anthony. On our demise.
Gone.
At this time, ONA realized, and this is very, very important.
Yes, yes.
And we live by this to this day. At this time, ONA realized that they could never, never,
never
be completely loyal to another radio station or company again.
That is it. Revelation. We had a moment of clarity right then and there that was the last time we would ever listen to anybody giving us what they think is advice for this show. Because only we know what is best for this program.
Hell, we love the stations we're on, but the reality is we can never completely be faithful and loyal to the stations we're on.
Hey, Rockhole, get ready for a visit to the Colonnade. And Dave sitting with you.
Hello? We're going to have to terminate your contract.
Uh-oh.
Oops.
Well, sorry to see you go, Rocco.
No, you too, Dave, you dick.
This time, ooh. Dave, you too. You too, Dave. So we were fired, Anthony.
Yes,
fired. This is kind of important. April 10th, 1998. You want to play the montage of us getting fired or we don't have time?
Oh, I don't know.
You want to play it?
Yeah.
We got. All right, let's play it before we move on with the timeline. This is how our firing was reported by the news stations in Boston.
WAAF DJs Opie and Anthony, who like to refer to themselves as demented, told their listeners Mayor Menino had been killed in a car accident. At the time it aired, the mayor's wife, Angela, thought her husband was in a car on the way to the airport, so she thought it was true. When the mayor's staff heard about the prank, they demanded a retraction.
Totally irresponsible.
Boston Mayor Tom Menino, thankfully, is alive and well, contrary to a radio station's so-called April Fool's joke.
WAAF DJs Opie and Anthony had announced on the air the mayor was killed in a car accident in Florida.
Tom Menino is very much alive and not at all amused.
It was an April Fool's joke.
Right.
Albeit a tasteless one.
Right.
But, you know.
Well, some of the listeners actually found it very funny. And yes. I do want to state that because we're getting a lot of, you know, flack that it was just, you know, shocking. There is some comedic value to it.
Now, the mayor plans to file a complaint with the FCC, and he may even sue the radio station. WAAF management says they've offered to let the mayor throw pies in the DJ's faces to raise money for charity. But tonight, Opie and Anthony told me they will not go along with that.
What?
What?
This is where it gets stupid.
You think saying the mayor was dead was crossing the line, huh?
Yeah. I feel bad that the mayor's, you know, wife heard it. Yeah. Who knew that the mayor's family is fans of the Opie and Anthony show?
Comanino was very upset. Adding to his anger was the fact that the on-air personalities never apologized.
We apologize to the mayor.
Never apologize.
I am sorry, mayor.
I will not accept the apology this time.
I am sorry, mayor.
Opie and Anthony killed Menino.
What?
Opie and Anthony killed Menino.
This is going to get you fired.
I am sorry, mayor.
You make me sick, you fat sack of crap.
The station initially tried to parlay this incident into a publicity stunt. Station owners did take the situation very seriously, and today, they acted.
Opie and Anthony repeatedly announced that Mayor Tom Menino had been killed in a car crash. Now WAAF has suspended the DJs indefinitely without pay. Mayor Menino is also seeking sanctions from the Federal Communications Commission.
Today, Opie and Anthony were gone. Fired.
Opie and Anthony are unemployed tonight.
Opie and Anthony have been terminated.
Fired.
And that looks like the last you're going to hear from either of these DJs for a while.
And if the former WAAF afternoon drive duo are looking for sympathy, they better not look on the streets of Boston.
I agree with it. I think they should have been fired, absolutely. I think they should have been fired. It's like someone saying that my mom is dead.
Opie and Anthony are off the air for good. Losers.
Opie and Anthony have been fired.
It was all just a joke.
Opie and Anthony delivered the joke on April Fool's Day, but the punchline knocked him right out of Boston radio.
They're dead air as far as their radio show is concerned.
That's no joke.
The station's keeping kind of a low profile as a couple of its top DJs go to no profile.
Instead of delivering jokes, Opie and Anthony are going to be delivering audition tapes.
Mayor Menino made a comment on that tonight, but in the statement, he said...
Hopefully, this incident will give all broadcasters pause.
Pause.
Opie and Anthony, we're nobody's bitch.
Pretty much the last thing ever said before our firing on the airwaves, by the way.
Can anyone take a joke anymore?
Anymore, Anthony. Yeah. There you have it. That's how they reported our firing.
Boy, that was rocking.
I love that. I love that, man. Jimmy put that together. He worked like 8 hours on that for us a while back. So the day after we got fired, April 10th, 1998... Mm-hmm. After getting rid of our hangovers, we vow we'll get our revenge on Dave Dickless and everyone else that turned their backs on us and didn't support us.
Yeah.
This is Earl's contribution to the bit right here, the OJs.
Yes, this is very appropriate. Business as usual. At the station. They hosed it down like Disney. Just like Disney, when there's an accident at Disney, they hose down the rides and get them started again. Get the people on it. Well, after we got the boot, Rockhole slips into our time slot, which he had had during our suspension, and didn't even acknowledge he was filling in for us. He just... Here he is, yeah. Right. He was filling in for us during that week that we were suspended, where no one knew if we were going to be fired or not. And instead of saying, "Hey, it's Rockhole filling in for Opie and Anthony," you know, hopefully they'll be back. And nothing. Never mentioned us. Started playing his own little sweepers. Made it his own show. Because he was really hoping we would get the boot so he could get the afternoon shift over there. Which he did get. And
he's regretting to this day.
Well, I guess he had a few good years there before we came back. But that's the bitterness there. You know, an acknowledgement that we were in that time slot. Maybe not listen to Dave Dickless at the time and talk about what happened.
Like Ozo.
And how cowardly and without a spine, management was, like the Ozone did, for firing us. Right, just like John Osterlin did.
We acknowledge the people that supported us.
He was doing the midday slot over there at AAF, and the guy's a true gentleman. And he's got a set of balls on him because he got on the air. And even though Dave Dickless said, don't mention ONA, don't take calls about them, John got on the air and talked about it. Not Rockhole.
Nah, this is mine now, baby.
Mine.
Mine.
Mine, all mine.
Well, I hope you enjoyed the fun before we got into town, fat boy. Hope you enjoyed the free ride.
April 10th, 1998, after getting rid of our hangovers, we vow we'll get our revenge on Dave Dickless and everyone else that turned their backs on us and didn't support us.
Turned their backs and walked away.
Little did we know that we'd have to wait almost 4 years. Four effing years.
Our exile lasted a little longer than what we would have liked. But in that 4 years, a bitterness built up.
Yes.
That is unrivaled.
Yes.
Our hatred, I'm glad it took that long, because I don't think our hatred was built up enough to come back into that city, into Boston, and rape your fat ass,
you frauds,
and rape your mouth, Dave, rape your mouth with your 70s porno mustache over it.
Wow, Ant, you're turning green over there. Relax.
Can't help it. Don't get me angry. You won't like me when I'm angry.
Yeah, Rocco moves into our time slot, never calling us to see if we're going to be okay. AF immediately begins doing their best to make believe we never existed.
Wiping the record clean.
Like they do in Russia.
Yeah. Whenever
they do in Russia.
Right, whenever a new leader comes about, what do? You get rid of any record of the old regime.
They just made believe we never even worked there, Anthony.
That's right. They had a whole retrospective on the station. Historical retrospective on WAAF in one of the trade magazines,
Friday Morning Quarterback.
One of the big radio industry trade magazines that go to all the radio stations. So they did this whole thing about the radio station. Not even a mention that we were there. Which, you know something? I don't care. Fine. You want to play that way? We'll come back and kill you. Destroy you! How is that? How is it? How is it, Dave? Pulling our seed out of your mustache. Pulling our man seed, which is dried up now like mashed potato flakes all over your face. All over your face!
All right, so even though AF does their best to make believe we never existed, our loyal listeners see right through this.
Right.
And I thank you personally for that.
Bless you.
We will never, ever forget that. The emails and the calls after we moved to New York City. Something else really fast. Anne-Marie, who worked at the station at the time.
Yeah.
She threw us a going-away party, Anthony.
Yep.
We were bitter, but there were some people we kind of got along with at the station, so we went with it, you know?
Guy in promotions, Otto.
Otto was there.
Always enjoyed him.
Ozone was there. All these people we mentioned are no longer with AF, by the way.
Right.
So Emery throws us a really nice going-away party. Most of the staff blows us off.
Yeah.
And the only air personality that shows up is Ozone.
Ozone. Johnny.
Where was Dave Dickless? Where was boys?
Where was Dave Dickless?
Where was Brucey?
Boys.
Where was the Hillman? Where was Rock Hole?
Brucey was suspended too. Where? Figuring out how to go on without acknowledging that we existed. There you go.
On June 1st, 1998, Opie and Anthony got kind of good news.
Huh?
Kind of good news.
Oh, Jesus.
Opie and Anthony are hired at WNEW in New York.
Good news relative to what? Cancer? This crap hole.
To this day, it's still a crap hole.
Unbelievable. Mama. The unflushable toilet.
Almost 4 years ago, we're hired here in New York at WNEW. The station is a complete disaster, with dinosaurs roaming the hallways playing classic rock music.
Jurassic effing Park, this place was.
No one is listening to this crap, Ant and I remember, thinking to ourselves. We say, F the music, and we start talking a real lot, Anthony.
I remember we had a music director here, like any station has. We were playing a hybrid of classic rock, new rock, and I believe classical jazz mambo music. I don't know what the format was at this place. But anything that was cool was banned from being played here. I remember one day I came in with one of my favorite new albums. And we got in trouble for playing Living Dead Girl.
That's
you remember
right.
that?
That's right.
Unbelievable.
It's safe to say that if you're listening to us right now, today, you were definitely not listening to us back on June 1st, 1998, when we hit the airwaves at this hellhole.
Right.
So we decide, F the music, and we start talking a real lot.
Yeah, because the truth of the matter was, when we started playing some of the music, we couldn't not comment on it.
Right.
When you're putting in Hot Legs... When you're putting in Hot Legs, you know, we can't just sit here. I believe halfway through Hot Legs, we pulled out the CD and started playing Rod Stewart Baseball.
Right.
Where we would take all the Rod Stewart CDs and pitch them in and hit them.
He's awful.
And in order to do that, we had a talk.
Right.
And for some reason, that started working.
Well,
much to the chagrin of...
Not at first.
The ice cream PD.
Because the hardcore listeners would say things like this.
This is not what I'm used to. This is different from what my normal daily experience is. Be like everything else in my life.
That's what they were saying, Tom.
Right.
Well, we turned things around slowly but surely. Over the next 3 years, we build an instant, insanely loyal following, and we thank New York for that, Anthony.
Not instant enough for me.
They embraced us, Anthony.
Yes, they did.
We brought back WAAF, the greatest radio promotion ever. It becomes huge once again, and might I say, even huger in New York.
Absolutely.
No offense to Mass, but it became huger in New York.
But with the support of a station...
Proving again that Dave Dickless didn't have a clue as far as radio goes.
If maybe we were allowed up there to make the bumper stickers, go out on sticker stops like we do here, hand them out, talk about it, get involved with it, send girls out to do it, you know, then WAAF takes off. When you have a spineless worm with a 70s porno mustache, 70s gay porno mustache, running the station, then it doesn't take off because he shuts it down.
All right, the Opie and Anthony timeline. It's going to end with the ratings that came out yesterday in Boston.
In Boston.
June 1st, 2001. We're moving fast now.
Yeah.
The Opie and Anthony show is syndicated to Philly.
Ah, Philly.
Philly!
We love Philly.
Want to thank Tim Sabian and WYSP for having the balls to be the first city to syndicate the Opie and Anthony show.
And again, we heard things like, this is not what I am used to.
Right. We understand.
We know how it works.
The boys realize they will finally be back on in Boston soon and can't wait to get their revenge on Dave Dickless, Rockhole, and the rest of the rest of the frauds at WAAF.
Took too long.
But as soon as we got syndicated, we're like, oh my God, now it's just a matter of time.
Yeah.
Since they're firing, AAF spent the next 3 years living off the success of ONA, pretending to be the only station that really rocks.
Yeah, right.
It should be noted that Ozone and others that helped get AAF on the map move on to better gigs, leaving AAF looking like a shell of its former self, Anthony. Shell of its former self.
When you have people in there.
The station that used to be cool, not cool anymore.
You got people in there that know what they're doing, that get attention on the air, that know good music, that hang with the artists. That's going to get you some listeners, right? When they all leave, you're left with Dave Dickless and Rockhole. You're done. You're done. Look at the book, Dave. Dave.
Are you looking at the book, Dave? It doesn't look good, does it, Dave?
What are you, Hal?
Open the pod bay doors, Hal. No, Dave.
All right, we got to take a quick break. We will wrap up the Opie and Anthony timeline when we get back with the ratings for Boston.
Oh, yeah.
When we get back, August 2001, we get syndicated back to Boston.
Back.
How old are you?
18.
All right. Pull your shirt off.
Wow.
Fabulous.
Well.
Opie Ravioli.
Opie and Anthony.
Opie and Anthony Show. 1027 WNEW.
And we're back with the Opie and Anthony Show. We're doing something a little different today. Looking back at some of the events. A little retrospective, sure, for the radio show. We're doing the Opie and Anthony timeline. We're just about done. It ends with the ratings that came out yesterday for Boston. So we're up to August 2001, Anthony. Roy. Less than a year ago. Opie and Anthony are syndicated back to Boston.
Thank God.
Syndicated back to Boston. And immediately go about the business of destroying what they built. Rah!
And destroy. Bastards.
Opie and Anthony decide.
Yeah.
That Dave Nicklaus and Rock Hall will have to pay with their jobs.
Right. We did say that. We will not rest until they are gone.
Fire. Fire. Dave Nicklaus had a brilliant strategy, Anthony, when we came to town.
Yes, his battle plan, Opie, his battle plan. He's got to get his troops ready, especially his afternoon show. How will they handle the return of the Opie and Anthony Show to the Boston airwaves on the competing station?
Dave's brilliant strategy
was
to tell his staff to ignore our attack. To just ignore them. What? They will go away.
His battle plan is to do nothing.
To do nothing.
Do nothing.
Just keep playing the music and shut your traps.
Right. No matter what they say, guys, no matter what happens, just ignore it. Just ignore it. It'll go away like you ignore a cancerous tumor. It goes away. No. Stupid strategy, Dave. And now you know what? Now it's too late. Now it's too late. Now if you start fighting, you're just going to look stupid.
You're exposed as the fraud you are. Boy, was that stupid.
Right.
Stupid, stupid, stupid.
Well,
you're a stupid, stupid man.
Because he's inept. He's stupid. He doesn't know how to program against a show like this.
So I want to beg and plead Rock Hall and the rest of the gang at AAF to at least fight back. To show they have some balls. To have some pride.
Have a little pride.
And go down swinging at least.
Wear the uniform when you deliver the fish to the boys at IBM.
Fight
a little pride.
Fight back, you phonies. What do they do, Anthony?
Nothing.
Even after we told them what would happen if they ignored us?
We spelt it out. You know, there's nobody that goes into war and spells out to the opponent what they're going to do to them. No one does that. We gave them that. We told them, we went on the air and said, look, here's how it's going to go down.
We did.
We are going to, like, get on the air and just pummel you. And unless you fight back, it is guaranteed you will lose. You'll probably lose even if you fight back, but at least you're fighting. Have a little pride. Make a stand. Do something. We spelt it out, and what did they do?
Nothing.
Listened to Dave Dickless. You listened, and now look at you. Now look.
You're exposed. You're a bunch of phonies. This, the only station that really rocks. Yeah,
right. Bye-bye.
Well, Anthony, we finally come to April 23rd, 2002. That, I do believe, would be...
Wait, let me look at my little watch here.
I think that was yesterday.
Yes.
Yesterday, right, Ant?
It certainly was yesterday. Yes, yes. Ratings came out yesterday. Dave Rocco and company. How are they doing?
They stink! We could have saved an hour and a half. They stink.
Stink.
It's what I do. It's all I do.
They are awful.
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 They stink.
They stink. The news, something that AF will not be telling their listeners.
Yeah.
They probably had, I looked back as far as I could, Anthony, they just had the worst ratings period in at least the last 10 years, if not longer. I can only go back 10 years, and I have not been able to see a lower number than what they got yesterday in the ratings.
Right.
So thank you to the ONA Army for seeing it our way.
Yeah,
the only way to see this one.
They had
if
an
you've been listening.
Abomination of a ratings book. An abomination. Horrid.
They horrid. Stink.
Very, very low numbers. As a matter of fact, I don't remember the numbers being lower.
That's what I said.
Yeah.
I looked back over the last 10 years.
10 years.
Because I'm that obsessed.
You did. A 10-year low.
I did a 10-year
study. It might be longer, but you couldn't go back any further?
I went back to like 91, 92.
Oh, my God.
And the station has never been lower. This could be the worst ratings ever.
Ever.
I don't want to say for sure because I don't have the info, but
right.
It could very well be the worst ratings ever for that station.
And
let me just put it in terms you could understand.
Okay.
Find people yes. of Boston.
Yes, yes.
Out of all the radios that are on right now listening to radio, in all those cars, look around, see all the cars? They all have radios in them. Okay? Maybe you're at a park and there's a few radios on, or maybe you're at a job and there's a radio on, okay? All the radios that are on right this second, less than 2% of them are listening to our old radio station.
Less than 2.
Less than 2%.
Bye-bye.
It gets uglier when you start talking about individual shows.
Yeah. How is our buddy Rockhole doing in afternoons? I saw a huge drop-off. And where it used to be this horse race between the station we're on and Rockhole... Now it is not even close. It's ridiculous.
It's so ridiculous that I hate to say this. We're pretty much going to have to move on. There's no fight here anymore.
Oh, but you know,
there's no fight.
But it's fun when Rockhole calls us.
I love when Rockhole
calls us.
He certainly can call from time to time.
And hey, guys.
And we will be paying attention, and we will look forward to the day that Dave is shown the door, which will happen soon, mark my words.
Oh, yeah.
No company will allow their radio station. Oh, wait. They're allowing that in New York.
Interesting. How does that work? Jeez. Then it could take a while.
Dave's in trouble. It's really obvious. And Rockhole is in deep ass.
Yep. It's over, Johnny. It is over.
Bye-bye. Back to Nebraska.
It is over.
With you. Jack off.
We did very well. Very well in
yes.
Boston. Number one in all the male demos once yeah. again, Anthony.
Uh-huh.
So I want to thank the ONA Army. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
And doing very good in even the ones that we don't care about.
Right. So it's just doing great across the board.
Yes.
And I think we're going to be doing something at the Sam Adams Brewery to celebrate.
Oh!
Details coming when we figure it all
really?
Out. Yeah. 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 So there you have it.
There you go. Thank you, Boston, for giving us what we wanted. A little bit of revenge. A dish that's best served cold. And, Captain Kirk, it is cold in space.
Gone!
Yes, and of course, you know, just because we really concentrated on Boston,
well,
doesn't mean that Washington
and Cleveland.
And Cleveland's ridiculous. I want to say it. Cleveland, guys, you got to get some kind of life outside of this show.
You know what?
You guys are, apparently... They're just listening to this program in Cleveland.
Yeah.
It's great.
Why don't we do this? So Cleveland and D.C., you know, so it doesn't sound like we're just tossing it aside. Anything.
Right.
We'll take a little break here. We'll regroup, and we'll give you the ratings for Washington, D.C., and Cleveland.
D.C.
But there you have it.
Uh-huh.
Thank you, Boston. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Do you have the ratings for Rochester? Because I'll be there May 18th.
Oh, God, you're despicable.
Scorch, what's going on?
Hey, man, you suppose Dave Dickless will now be looking for pizza as opposed to hamburgers?
Ah, perhaps oh, now you could get your job back there, Scorch.
No, I don't want my job back. Hey, welcome to my family, guys.
What are you talking about?
You are now on in Albany at a station owned by the same people that own my station.
Hey, is that true, Scorch?
You're going to do extremely well there. Good for you. I'm glad for you.
Hey, very happy.
We're going to have fun with Albany.
Yeah, Albany's actually...
We're in day three of the Albany experiment, and we're just giving them a face full of crap so far.
Yeah. Don't worry, Albany.
But I just wanted to call up and say hey and congrats for keeping on going, man. You guys are...
All
right. You guys are
thank you, Scorch. And you rock Syracuse.
Yes, I do. Thanks. Scorch1.com, by the way. Let me give myself a plug. Scorch1.com.
Scorch1.com. Check it out. Kingdom of Nicodemus.
Yeah, do check it out. What's going on, guys? Long time no hear from.
Did you go see the legend last night, sir?
What's up?
Did you go see Dice last night? He was in Syracuse.
Oh, no, I didn't.
No, I didn't.
No.
Syracuse is... Well, that's kind of close, yeah. We're going to have Dice on the show today. Scorch, we got to let you go because we got to take a quick break.
Yeah, we got to go to commercial.
If you want to call back later, we'd love to talk to you.
Cool, man.
All right.
You guys.
Oh, wait.
What?
Oh, God. I love that kid. I can never hear that enough.
Oh, wait.
Oh, and... All right. So we'll take a break. We'll regroup. Yeah. And we'll pretty much start today's Opie and Anthony show.
Right.
I hope you enjoyed the timeline. We had a lot of fun putting that together.
Yes.
Actually, like, preparing for a show. It was kind of interesting.
Never do that again.
We had notes and cues. And
what the hell's that all about?
All sorts of stuff
Jesus.
Going on there. All right. A couple phone numbers in the New York area, 877-692-1027. Anywhere else outside of New York, including Cleveland, Washington, D.C., and, of course, Boston, 866-277-4WOW.
Opie and Anthony.
And on the eighth day, God said, let there be breasts.
Boobs.
Wow. We're back with the Opie and Anthony show. Thanks for checking us out today. Ratings are coming in for all the cities, so you got to bear with us. Really fast, the rundown thus far.
Yeah.
Ratings came in for New York. We're still number one. Men 18 to 49, the reason we were hired to do this radio show. But the ratings weren't that great. Not going to lie to you. We've seen much better here in New York, but we're still number one. So number one is still number one, I guess.
Right.
But we weren't completely stoked about the ratings in New York City.
No,
not at all. Then Philly came in, Anthony, and we destroyed.
Yes.
Destroyed in Philly. Someone was telling me the highest ratings in afternoon drive for WYSP ever.
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 Number one in every male demo, Tim Sabian was telling us the other day. And by a long shot, like no one's even close.
Yeah, ridiculous numbers. Thank you so much
Philly.
Let's just put it this way. In New York, they're starting to get close. They're starting to get close. Hello? Hello? They're starting to get close.
Hello?
But Philly just, we just destroyed in Philly. We just gave you the hour and a half rundown of the Boston thing.
But when this station goes all polka, perhaps that'll boost our numbers a little bit.
There you go. Boston, once again, number one men 18 to 49, the reason why we're doing this radio show. Don't forget that. Number one in just about all the male demos, I believe. I don't have them in front of me, but doing very, very well. No complaints in Boston.
Yeah.
New York, hello. 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 You're freaking us out a little bit. Hello.
You out there? Hello.
Right.
Hello.
Ding dong. Stop freaking us out.
Hello.
Tell a friend. Get that wild sticker on your car. Hello.
Where are you from?
We're all pals, right?
Yeah. What happened? Hello, New York?
New York.
Hi. New York, you here? Everyone else is here. Boston, Philly.
Right.
D.C., Cleveland. Wow, look at how many people from Cleveland are here. Hello.
Right.
Hello. Oh, someone new is in here. Are they from New York? Hello? Hello? Hi. Hello?
Anyway.
New York?
So Boston, no complaints. Philly, no complaints. New York, we're a little nervous.
What are you doing?
A little bit. All right. Well, then the ratings for Cleveland came out yesterday afternoon, Anthony.
Yes.
And the only way, I don't even know how to describe the ratings for Cleveland.
Ridiculous.
I guess you could say holy S.
They're insane.
Holy S.
It's almost as if somebody may have made a mathematical error when they added them up.
Right.
And didn't catch it. That's how stupid, ridiculous they are.
We got like I'm hearing a 25 share. Men 18 to 34, that's just ridiculous.
Men 18-34.
Holy Toledo.
Basically, yes. Guys in Cleveland would rather listen to our show than get laid.
No, they wouldn't.
Yes, they would.
It's amazing.
Hey, man, it's just a joke. Relax.
I think it's easier to count the people that aren't listening to the show.
Everyone said we were blown up in Cleveland. Well, we got proof now.
Goddamn love you, Cleveland.
Ridiculous proof. And for the first time, Anthony, the reason we do this radio show, let's not forget, is men 18 to 49.
Yes.
That is it. I mean, if you read our contracts, that's what you'll see.
Contracts?
Who has time to read that horse crap?
To get them to listen or date them? What are you talking about? What's important to us?
Who has
18 to 49?
Who has?
Well, they start losing the abs at 50. Don't they, Garrett?
Who has time to read our contracts?
Right.
200 pages of horse ass. It's all bull crap. Promise things that don't happen.
Yeah.
Whatever. Whatever, we're cool with it. Relax. Stop making your phone calls. We're fine.
Everything's fine.
I wanted to write.
So Cleveland, ridiculous. And for the first time, Anthony, in Cleveland, men 18 to 49, number one for the first time.
Right.
By far, by the way. By far.
Thank you, Cleveland.
Finally, this morning, Washington, D.C., the ratings came in.
Washington. Now, if you recall...
Yeah, you want to, like, set up the Washington situation.
Washington, very tricky situation.
A little bit.
In the nation's capital.
A little bit.
We went into the slot that was held by Don and Mike in Washington, D.C. for many years.
As far as Washington goes, there was no reason to remove them from their spot.
No, they had huge ratings. Number one... and it was ridiculous, their ratings. Very good. Number one. And then, in order to get people on other stations and whatnot, some day parts were shifted around.
We had to do some shuffling.
Some shuffling, as they say. For them to be live in New York, for us to be live in D.C., they went to middays. We took afternoons in D.C.,
and we took a face full of ass.
People
everybody.
Were so pissed off.
Everybody.
The company
oh, my
hated
God.
Us.
Washington hated us. Everybody hates us.
See, most of the times this program is put in a station in a city that is doing either well, you know, okay, or just in a crappy situation. And we are there to bring it up out of the toilet or whatever. The slot we took in D.C. was... highly rated. And we stepped in and just
erased all of those ratings. We chased away everybody that was listening from 3 to 7 in Washington,
D.C.
Remember
the quote from Ken Stevens. Do you remember it exactly?
That one?
He's never seen more of a
bigger ratings disaster.
A bigger ratings disaster.
In the history of his career. We went in and pretty much just alienated everyone from the 3 to 7 slot at WJFK in D.C.
Everyone.
That was it.
All right. Before we give you the ratings in D.C., Eric from Philly with a very funny instant feedback, Anthony. Can you guys do the Washington timeline? And
yeah.
Then he does it.
Oh, he does?
Yeah, September 2001. Crickets chirping.
Crickets chirping. Yeah, okay.
October 2001. Crickets chirping. November 2001. Crickets chirping. December 2001. You guessed it. Crickets chirping. January 2002. Someone coughs. Uh-huh. Followed by crickets chirping.
Right.
February 2002, lady writes in saying O&A will never last, and Stephanie shows her awesome cans.
Oh.
March 2002, people realize their cars are equipped with radios. April 2002, O&A rule Washington.
There you go.
Well, at least someone is listening. He finishes. Well, we're not ruling Washington.
No, it's a slow climb out. Actually, it's working out pretty well.
Yes. We are proud to announce. Remember, we're all about men 18 to 49. Hey, we love when the ladies listen. We love when the younger men listen. We love when the older men listen. Matter of fact, in a lot of these cities, we're number one men across the board from 12 all the way up to 54, Anthony.
Right.
But as you focus in what we're all about, it's men 18 to 49. Anyone from the company will tell you that. Washington, D.C., men 18 to 49, the Opie and Anthony Show, number one. Number
Bravo.
One.
Bravo.
Number one.
Thank you, Washington, D.C.
Number one.
Look at that.
And going up everywhere. Still got some work to do.
Of course we do.
As far as overall listenership.
It was such a disaster that we still have work to do. Oh, my God. What a disaster that was. But now D.C. coming aboard.
Number one. Men 18 to 49, Washington, D.C. Look it up for yourself, all you naysayers.
There you go.
All you people that want to rip into the show. Look it up. It's there for your viewing pleasure.
People listening.
D.C. and Cleveland and, of course, Boston. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, New York. All right.
Yeah. Come on there, New York.
Huh?
I'd like to compliment the Pope.
What?
Just on the old front page of the Daily News, it was just a very poignant Pope on priest pedophilia. It's a crime, and that's what the Pope said, and I just wanted to say that he doesn't miss anything. That Pope is right on top of things.
He's sharp in his old age.
He also came out and said that Shaq is tall and the earth is round. Pope is on fire with the poignant statements. The point on the Pope on his hat. It's pointing. Wow. 81 years old. Still sharp as a tack, isn't he? Boy, oh boy. Only 40,000 duck walking little fellas, and he decides to speak up and say it's a crime.
Duck walking little fellas.
Wah, wah. Ow. I got to sleep on my tummy.
Did you see how they gave a description of Crinkle Crinkle? In one of the shows that was on Comedy Central the other day?
What do you mean?
It's some show where some guy takes challenges, and one of his challenges...
Oh, the tourist show?
Yeah.
Tourist stinky nose.
He had to spank it in the same bathroom that George Michael spanked it in.
Or he tried to pick up guys in that bathroom.
What was he doing, Stinky?
It's called Travel Sick.
Travel Sick.
And he had to try to get a guy to bang him in George Michael's bathroom.
To have sex with him? Really?
Yeah. So he's hitting on him saying, you know, I like apples and oranges.
It goes both ways.
Yeah. So what about Crinkle Crinkle?
And then they actually described how that was done. He said he took out a bag, a shopping bag, and he put it on the floor, and he made the guy step into it. And he goes, like he was sitting on the bowl. The guy is standing with his butt facing him. And he goes, now you stand in the bag. Now you can sit on my lap, and they can go to town that way. And if a cop or somebody looks underneath the stall, all he sees is a guy sitting on the ball. Maybe he's done some shopping. Uh-huh. So he's got the bag in front of him. No one knows that the feet of a young lad could be in there or something, and there's some gay
Central,
sex
right?
going on. Yeah.
Comedy Central who won't give me a special, and yet they find that and be, ho, hey.
Wait a minute, Norton. I understand you're a little angry with Comedy Central.
No, I'm not even angry with them. I've done some things with them, and it's terrific, but just...
They edit you a little much. They don't let you hit on some of your more blue material, as they would put it. But they describe Crinkle Crinkle pretty well, and gay man backdoor action sex in the bathroom.
Yeah.
But you can't...
No, don't do my the thing about the deformed girl and banging her for $50 or a hair lip or a burn victim. Don't do that line, because it might offend deformed people. But if you're a cartoon, and you talk like that. Boy, that cartoon is hilarious. I don't watch it. It's overrated, and it sucks.
Not a big South Park fan.
No, it's overrated.
You got some of your lines in the South Park show, though, bro. Bucket of
AIDS. You know why it's a hit? Because it's the only pseudo-edgy thing on television, and they're not real people, you dopes. Let a real person say it, and then you got balls.
Yeah, they will not allow you to go on stage during a special and say the same type of material.
A special? What is that?
Oh.
Oh, yeah, where you do it for more than 4 minutes?
Yeah. Wait, what?
Oh, God. Damn.
Oh, that
really annoys me. Oh, he's very angry.
Yeah, I just, I hope no one calls me a chicken butt, because then I'll have to sue.
My stupid voice.
They come up with some real good lines for this show, though. This is one of my favorites.
How about a nice bucket of AIDS?
Oh.
Will somebody put this retard out of his misery?
Hot lunch? Can you not make fun of, you know, you can't make fun. I couldn't do the prosthetic line because it might offend people with prosthetic.
Are you kidding?
Oh, no, I'm not kidding. Watch the tape.
You can't even talk about prosthetics?
I have the original, uncut.
Yeah.
And I have the edited version. And it just makes me want to vomit.
Oh. All right. Let's go to the phone.
It's very angry.
I don't want to.
I will kick you in the nuts.
Yeah, all right. Now, the reason I mentioned, should I just mention this real quick? Because this made me really, really want to put someone's face into a toilet. The suit over the, what you call chicken butt.
Chicken butt.
Jennifer Seelig sued, or whatever station, in San Francisco after Vincent Crackhorn of the Sarah and Vinny Morning Show. How awful must that be? I'm Sarah, and I'm Vinny, and we stink. Called, because she had an audition for, like, who wants to marry a millionaire. So I guess calling her a C would have been the more appropriate thing. And they called her a local loser and a chicken butt.
Are you kidding?
And she sued for, I don't know how much money.
Are
they,
you kidding? Like she, a listener she, goes she, down, and they call her a chicken butt, and she sues?
Wow,
don't set that precedent.
2000 Fox contestant on Who Wants to Marry a Millionaire. And they called her a chicken butt, which shows you how awful that show is.
Hey, chicken butt.
Hey, Sarah, do you think she's a chicken butt? She's a local loser, Vinny. Hey, don't elbow that. It's my uterus. Guy and a gal, you know, getting everybody listening and laughing, tussling each other's hair.
Waking you up in the morning with a little chicken butt madcap humor. Playing chicken Battle butt. Of the Sexes, everyone.
Ho-ho! I'll bet you she didn't marry that millionaire because she had a chicken butt.
Hubla, hubla. Yuck, yuck, yuck.
Let me hold my ribs. Chicken butt? That stinks. That's only funny if you're talking about, like, an Ethiopian. Like, ah, look at him. He's got a chicken butt. You know? Why? Because it's, like, skinny? No, because there's flies on it.
Oh, Jesus.
Flies on people jokes, always funny.
Don't say it on Comedy Central, though.
Oh, no, because they might get hit with flies listening, and they might get offended.
Bill from D.C., what's up?
I hate people with
flies. Since the ratings are up in D.C., I was wondering if you were going to come to the Norton Show on the 10th.
We will be broadcasting live down there in
yes.
D.C.
Very good.
Yes, we will.
That is
a guarantee, so we're hoping a lot of people will show up at the station when we're there.
You're going to be at JFK?
Hell yeah.
All right.
We feel like we could at least show our faces. Just show them, say, hey, what's going on, you know?
Mugs.
See what it's all about.
Perfect. Very good.
Yeah, we'll
Norton, you rule.
Thank you, sir.
Bill will definitely be down there. There you go. We're coming down. Opera Mary wants in on the show. Opera Mary, I got to explain. Ant and I decided to do this Opie and Anthony timeline, and we didn't want any distractions or anything. And we forgot that Opera Mary is doing a WOW sticker stop here in New York.
No, we're in New Jersey.
Get a hold of yourself.
Relax,
man.
Wow.
Jesus Christ.
Wow.
Wow. New Jersey.
Oh, man.
Row. Row.
We're in Jersey.
You all right? Relax, dude.
All right, I'm relaxed.
Chill.
I'm excited. How's that?
All right, so she's out. Where are you in Jersey? I don't even know.
We're on the northbound side of Route 17, right at the Paramus Auto Mall. We're right in front. You cannot miss us. Hello?
Yes, listening.
Oh, I thought you hung up on me.
No. This is very important.
Yes, it is. We are on the northbound side. So make sure that it's Route 17 in New Jersey. The Paramus Auto Mall. It's actually really nice out here. The staff is nice, so come and visit us. We'll be here for another 20, 25 minutes.
Yeah, or so. They've been there for 2 hours. No one has shown up because no one knows they're there today because we were supposed to promote it on our show. So guys, if you're in the area, stop by, say hi to Opera Mary and the gang, and get your WOW stickers, okay?
All right.
All right, thank you, Opera Mary.
Goodbye, Opie.
Opera Mary.
Still hasn't sang any opera for us in here.
That chicken butt.
A little stanza. Chicken butt.
Yeah. Rock Hole. Hey, Rocco, what's up?
Dopey?
Yes, Rock Hole. Cheer up, Rock Hole. You still got Dave. Yeah, and I'm sure when you get fired, you'll get an opportunity in New York City, just like we did.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it.
Think?
Things are looking up for you.
We're coming back.
Yeah.
I got new ideas.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
What are you going to do? Some good fake radio?
Don't call it. All right. You want to know the truth?
Yeah.
For the Jamaica thing, it's really just Dave's office, a kiddie pool. And we dump some sand.
Is that what your Jamaica trip is?
Yeah.
That was supposed to bring back the ratings, I think.
Yeah, that's like one of those things that is supposed to boost your ratings.
Why do you think they're so low? We were found out.
That's some smart thinking. Your afternoon drive show stinks so bad, Dickless decides, hey, time for a vacation.
Go to Jamaica.
We'll send him to Jamaica.
You know, well, I can't even take my shirt off to go in the pool.
No, Rockhole?
Because I got those huge... Man, boob. Awful. I'm so embarrassed.
Yeah?
And Maddie's got such a little chicken butt. It's just...
Oh, my God. You shouldn't say chicken butt.
It's edgy radio. I'm coming back.
It's edgy radio.
Yeah, you and your edgy radio.
You are coming back, though.
Woo! Yeah. Sure, I'm throwing a bucket of AIDS.
Yeah, sure looks like you're coming back there, Rockhole.
That's mine, too.
All right. All right, Rockhole. Thank you, Rockhole.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. There you go.
I hope you didn't spend that bonus.
By the way, can I say how nice it is? I think that three women are pregnant with clones in Italy. And can I say, finally...
You like this?
No, I love it.
Really?
Yeah, fat and awful-looking people. Bye-bye. Your time on this planet is short-lived.
You think this is going to work?
Yeah.
No. Now they're gonna find out that it
don't work.
Something is a little screwy
with
the cloning.
Yeah. Well, you know what else? Something was screwy with the first time the Wright brothers got in that little plane and flew 20 feet, and now look at us zipping all over the place.
So they're gonna
I do believe they also died in air crashes.
You know what? All right. So hey, look. How many Pam Andersons can you have? As many as you need.
That's right.
The beauty of cloning.
I think this cloning thing, it's going to be a little wacky and a little kooky at first.
A little tricky?
It won't affect Maury's show. I mean, it's all like those zeros are going to be, like, squeezed out yet.
You're going to have people, their eyes are going to be a little cross-eyed a little bit.
Yeah.
For now.
You know what I think it's going to be like? You ever see those books that come out every so often? Hey, make your own Twinkies at home. And it's got the ingredients on how to make a Twinkie. Or make your own Big Mac. At home, and you cook it, and the ingredients are there, and everything's exactly the same as they make at Hostess or McDonald's, or when you're making your own yodel at home, or whatever the hell it is. And what happens? It ain't quite right, is it?
No, but that's you're missing the beauty of it.
What?
One of those little Twinkies. It doesn't taste quite as good, but I'll tell you, if you hold it, and you warm it, and you put your mule there, you can't tell the difference. That's the beauty of it. Maybe it's not tasty, but darn it, it feels good when you get dumped again.
You're condoning effing freak clones?
That's why they should be made. All you got to do is just make a girl who all she can say is, I have to tinkle, and sure, I'll suck that. And she cries and goes, thank you. That's why I'm all right. For cloning.
Okay.
Do you want to vote?
No.
So all she wants to do in that and tongue your balloon knot.
Do you think they would be second-class citizens? Is there a way to make one so you can just have one as a servant or a sex slave?
Yeah, go down south and meet any girl. That's what it's about. They're raised proper down there.
Buy them from their parents for a few shiny pieces.
I love the cloning. I'm all for the cloning. I'm all for it.
I think, like Ope says, though, they're going to come out a little funny and a little silly.
I agree. That's why you keep
a little
it simple.
Off.
You
don't a little off.
A little off.
They're going to get some of those diseases that we've kind of cured already.
Yeah, that we kind of cured. Make
also,
up some new ones.
Also,
yeah.
Like, wait a minute. Didn't we cure that? Something's going to happen.
Hey, maybe the church can get in on this, and you can make little fella clones that don't testify. How would that be? Hey, look, no duck walking.
The possibilities are endless.
I think it's going to be more like, if you try to clone Patrick Swayze, you get Patrick Swayze's brother.
Oh, boy.
Just a little. It's like Patrick Swayze. You could tell, they're from the same line. But it's just a little off,
just
ain't
a little
it?
Off. Like, Tom, you want to clone Tom Hanks, you get his brother.
You get Tom Hanks' brother.
Oh, boy. Well, it almost looks like Tom Hanks if he was retarded.
I tuned it out of my peripheral vision. I thought I saw Tom Hanks on the TV.
Right.
But then when I turned, I went, oh, wait a minute.
Well, he did the running scene in Gump. That was Hanks' brother.
Oh, was it?
With the beard,
how about that?
We have talked about this on our show many times. We have this observation. You see the celebrity brothers on a lot of these talk shows from
right.
time to time. And you know what? If you're the brother of someone famous, you can't help but looking like that famous person if they were retarded.
Right.
A little off. A little off. A little silly. It sucks to be the brother or the sister of someone famous.
And it wouldn't be murder. Let's just say you have a little clone and he's acting up. You kill him.
Is that all?
Yeah, you take a little DNA, you start over.
Well, a lot of people saying maybe you could clone yourself.
Exactly.
And then you freeze him. You need one of these organs or something.
Exactly.
There you go. You got one.
Logan's Run had a point. Eventually, we will be euthanizing people at a certain age because disease will be eradicated. But how great would that be? Cry, cry. Shake, shake. Whoops. He quit breathing. Marge, get another one out of there.
Get another one out of the closet.
Yeah, or out of your box. Wherever you keep the little fellas.
But if you need a heart or a liver transplant or something.
Yeah, exactly.
What would stop you? Let's say right when you're born, they clone you. Right? Now, your clone gets to grow up, but in a farm environment, not in this human thing where you contact with other humans so they fall in love or something. That's how it's got to be done because you can't clone someone already grown up.
You're talking like veals.
Right.
Kind of like the livers.
You grow them to the age where you can harvest organs. Then they are frozen or somehow kept where the organs will be okay. Then if you need an organ later in life, you have a nice, young, healthy organ.
But then there's the...
I'm completely pulling any morality out of this.
Yeah,
mix.
But then there
believe
is
me.
Then there is the question about, well, what if they have a soul? I mean, I don't know about... I don't know about...
Oh, they will have a soul.
Oh, they
well,
will
you know
soul.
What you could do?
You can't do that.
Right when they're born, or right when you clone them, and the clone is then born, you take out the part of their brain. You make them a vegetable, but you let their organs keep growing in the body.
And then maybe then Will Sampson can shake them and smother them with a pillow and throw the sink through the window. How does that go? I can't leave you like this. I'm taking you with me.
You bloody baboon, you've cut out his brain.
You know, something like that, where then he wouldn't have to think and fall in love and grow up and get educated. It would just be a life support system for completely... compatible organs for
Mac,
you.
Mac, are you going to say goodbye to me, Mac?
Settle down, Charles. I'm not talking about my wife. I'm talking about my life. God, the devil, heaven, hell. Do you understand?
Settle down.
Finally, please. But sometimes you gang up on me.
Ron
please.
Hey. What?
Samantha.
Yes.
What are you talking about?
What about Ron and Fez?
Oh, no. Did you listen to them last night, to the Osbournes? I know it has absolutely nothing to do with what you're talking about.
No,
why?
Okay, if you could clone somebody, wouldn't you think Ron Howard would clone his ugly brother?
Who, Clint Howard?
Yes.
Yeah, when you look at Clint... No, Clint Howard is so far gone, like it isn't even near Ron
That's
Howard.
Cloning gone bad.
And then you just think of him as the kid on Star Trek.
Right. Ha, ha, ha. We are a lot alike, Captain Kirk. Have some Tranya. Ah, ha, 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 ha. Look at my ship, Captain. We both love our ships. Remember the little kid?
No.
You don't watch
I was
Trek.
Never a Trek fan. Sorry.
You were never a nothing fan.
I was busy looking at Marilyn Chambers videos. I really didn't care what Leonard Nimoy, or is it Nimoy, was doing when he wasn't hosting Awful In Search Of, which accomplished nothing.
I loved In Search Of.
Yeah, so did everyone in the 70s.
I love the Loch Ness Monster episode.
And it was a fraud, you dopes out there. The surgeon admitted his photo was a fraud. The most famous photo of Nessie.
He did?
Yes, he did, on his deathbed. He admitted it was a fraud.
Well, that's just to throw everyone off.
No, that was the most famous photo.
Wouldn't you pull the ultimate gag on your deathbed? I like the guys that strap the big Bigfoot feet on and walk in the woods.
Yeah.
Make the footprints.
But the worst part is you see those big feet and you're like, oh, I got to grab that sea because it's got to... And then you're like, oh, you...
I bet it's tasty and big.
Yeah.
Hey, is Dice coming in here today?
Yeah.
All right, well, we got to take a break.
I used to do an awful bit on the Bigfoot, and if anything they say about the size of a fella's feet, it was just a bit.
Wait.
Never
got speaking of which, you promised that you'd bring in your first...
I got to find the tape. I know. Dude,
he's got a tape of his first few months of doing comedy.
Six months. It was a Bud Light competition.
Yeah.
And I do have it somewhere. It's only like 3 minutes. It was for Fox. They only taped three. It wasn't on TV. It was at Rascals and One Stars. I was horrendous.
Really?
Got to bring that tape.
Oh, I will.
We're going to do a show where everyone brings in their embarrassing tapes.
Oh, I got
some. And I got one from 93 really stink.
Rick brought his in today.
Rick brought a videotape, and unfortunately...
Hey, can we take a break, and then we'll explain Rick's embarrassing tape?
It's great.
And you got to bring in your tape?
I have a couple. They're terrible.
Right. I have a tape of me with my band As Is doing a love ballad. It is horrendous. Horrendous.
As Is?
Yeah.
A-Z-I-Z.
Right?
Oh, Arizona Is? No.
Sorry.
As Is.
Stop it. We all have those. Shut up.
Yeah, we all do.
Awful.
I want to hear your awful comedy.
Dude, it's brutal.
What do you have, Opie?
I got my XFL tapes.
Oh, Jesus.
I don't know. I would have to think about
it. You would have to break out a really embarrassing break that you did on radio.
Well, that's
easy. Or do you have any Spuds Buckley?
Yeah, I got that.
Bring in Spuds Buckley. Come on. That's like, no, I'm laughing. We all bring in one completely embarrassing audio tape of us. Do that. Come on, let's work on that.
Shut up, Jim. Douchebag.
Spuds Buckley.
There wasn't anyone around during my time to just take me under his wing and put me on a great radio show. I had to do it myself.
I'm Kenny Credit Giver. I realize. Believe me, you think I don't know that I'm just like there's two coattails and I happen to grab onto them? I'm the first one to admit that and then look at myself in the mirror and go, lucky.
You think Anthony lucked out? Jesus.
I know. He had 7 years of work to do to pave the way for meaty breasts.
And I've been working at this for 7 years, and we just toss you a little bone.
Hey, you
just a little one.
And I think you guys, and I love you both so much, every time there's a head going, blah, 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 I'm like, those guys are really good friends.
All right, we'll go to the FU line. We'll talk about Rick's embarrassing tape.
I never knew about this.
Okay, Rick, do you at least have the audio? Where's Rick?
Tell him to get the audio of the actual people in the scene talking about where they are.
Yeah, get the audio. He'll get the audio, and then we'll kind of fill in the pictures for you.
Right.
But first, it's the FU line.
Thanks for calling, and here's the Opie and Anthony FU line.
Hey, I'd like to leave a big FU to the idiots at the show last night who had to repeat the punchline of every single joke.
Next message.
Yeah, this is a big FU going out to the protesters in Washington, D.C. who are blocking the f***ing intersection. I need to go to Motorhead tonight. They're blocking the friggin' intersection. FU, protesters.
Next message.
Hey, this is a big FU to MTV for not playing a damn thing about Lane Staley's and Alice in Chains dying on 420. FU.
Next message.
This is a big fat you to everybody in Seattle and Portland. Every time any of you call Opie and Anthony, you can talk about how it's raining. Nobody cares that it's raining. Nobody cares. Everybody already knows. Shut the up about the weather already. Nobody cares.
End of messages.
Let them hang like the animals they are.
The Opie and Anthony Show, 1027
WNEW. Bring this show to a halt.
Oh, screeching halt.
I don't know. Whistle Bell Wednesday. Whistle Bell Wednesday.
Whistle Bell Wednesday.
Whip Them Out Wednesday.
Oh, this is fantastic. This is beautiful.
It's Whip Them Out Wednesday. Yeah. Whip Them Out Wednesday.
Those are real.
How about the woman that took the shirt off?
Ah, yeah.
Sexy girls. Sexy, sexy girls.
You have sorry.
Wow.
Girls show boobs. Boobs. I see boobs.
Yes.
He just got wowed.
That's nice.
Opie and Anthony.
Hey, yeah!
It's world renowned.
It's Whip 'em Out Wednesday. It's Whip 'em Out Wednesday.
Yeah.
Whip 'em Out Wednesday.
Those are real.
Cancel your appointment.
Okay.
It's Whip 'em Out Wednesday. It's Whip
'em
Out Wednesday.
Yeah. Whip 'em Out Wednesday.
For the Opie and Anthony show. Yes, it's Whip 'em Out Wednesday.
All right. Why don't we have a girl here wowing for us today?
That doesn't make sense.
Oh, we had Gloria Ann the other day.
Yeah, that was a treat.
I was checking out the video and the pictures up on foundrymusic.com.
Very good.
Stunning.
Huh? Smoke on.
Yeah, wow is definitely taking off here in New York. I would have to say better than last year at this time, Anthony.
Yeah. Yes.
Every week you're seeing more and more wows on the highways and the byways and at the construction sites and on the side of buildings and
wherever you can display it.
Thanks for the support as far as wow goes. Supports the show, and it also gives you a chance to see a girl topless.
Yes.
Girls do this every single day for the Opie and Anthony show. It's basically whip them out whenever at this point. Right, Ann?
They search for guys with a wow on their vehicle. They're looking. We've gotten calls from girls that say, look, I'm willing to wow, but I know you guys don't want me showing my cans to anybody unless they got a wow on their vehicle. Yeah, that's absolutely right. And what guy in their right mind isn't going to put a wow somewhere? Maybe you got a wife who's a little bit of a stick in the mud. Or a C. Whatever, however you want to put it. You know what? You don't have to put a
big... There's a lot of mileage between a stick in the mud and a C.
There's a lot to cover there, but
there's
we all know what I mean.
There's got to be a few adjectives in between stick in the mud and C.
Not really, no.
No, that's it. Stick in your C. I like that. All right, don't be a stick in the C.
There's no gray area. It's either
none.
Black or white,
yes,
huh?
None.
The gray area is taint.
And it better not be gray. Ugh, pew.
It was beautifully marbled meat, man. It was turning gray. They threw all that taint. I'm saucier.
So what about this wife that might be a stick
right.
in the mud?
Maybe, because we've heard from guys, poor henpecked guys. They, you know, they're beaten down and broken by their women. And they say, you know, I can't put a wow on my vehicle because the old lady's going to give me crap about it if she sees it.
The old whorebag.
The old slut rag chicken butt.
Oh,
maybe.
Hey.
Oh, now, hey. Now I've gone comedy too far. Hey. I've gone too far. Well, you know what?
This small.
The old hot, thin piece of ass that used to hob your knob.
Yeah. Oh.
Maybe you just need a little wow somewhere. Somewhere in the back window of your car. Something you can grab maybe and throw in the garbage for that week before you drive home. Before you pull up in your garage.
Yeah, the wow stickers are disposable if you have to use them that way.
Yeah, whatever.
Put it on your car for the ride home, and just before you drive up to the nightmare that is your
life and your marriage and your children.
You put it in your pocket.
Yeah, yeah, you kind of just...
Oh, no. Don't put it in the pocket. You might find it there.
You toss it out the window.
What's this? A wow sticker? She freaks out on you.
You tell her you confiscated it from someone and you were going to bring it to the police.
Kind of like
the same thing you do with those escort numbers. Just before you get home,
you got to throw them away.
Yeah, you throw them out the window.
Maybe a little lipstick on your collar.
Hey, you throw the shirt away. Say you had an accident at work.
Yeah.
Go get another one.
A little oil on there.
Right.
That's why you ran out to the store to buy a new T-shirt.
Right.
Jesus. Drive home to that nightmare.
Got the little fold marks in the sleeve of your T-shirt. That's how you know your husband is cheating if every day he comes home with a T-shirt with little fold marks down the middle and in the sleeves.
Little fold mark.
Yeah,
don't ruin it for the guys out there.
Perfectly folded.
That are just trying to get by.
Well, that's what you got to do. You got
guys that can't afford a divorce and just have to...
But no one can afford a divorce.
Put that smile on their face as they pull into the driveway every night.
Oh.
Good to see you.
Oh.
Anyway.
Disgusting.
Where were we?
I had to bring up a story, though, that I gotta tell.
Oh,
back in my younger days. Back in my younger days, Opie.
Oh,
I was seeing a girlfriend, and I was cheating. I was cheating on her. I finally decided
you were cheating.
Make the jump and cheat.
You, Anthony.
Yes,
were cheating.
Yes, I was. I finally decided to plunge right in and cheat on this girl.
Couldn't get them all in one room, huh?
Shut up! There's no photographic evidence. No, this was, you know, I was single. I wasn't married. This was well before my marriage. Yeah. It was just, you know, seeing a girl.
Yeah.
And I decided to cheat.
Cheat?
But then I had to go see the girl, you know?
Oh, boy.
Yeah. So,
What to do?
I had certain fragrances and aromas on my hands and whatnot.
Oh, boy.
Now I'm like, all right, what do you do? What do you do?
Yay.
You make sure when this happens you're driving a car that is not dependable. Not dependable. So that way when I doused my hands in gasoline and grease and oil and wiped it all over me and drove to the house and walked in the door, the first thing out of my mouth is, son of a bitchin' car! And as she came over to me, I went, I'm full of gasoline. I got to take a shower. And I was able to bypass that situation with petroleum.
How did she
eventually catch you, Anthony?
No, you know something? I don't cheat for long. That's what happens. I leave the situation. Believe me. I don't cheat for long.
Right.
I never cheated for very long.
It's
not something I leave go for a long time.
The guilt gets to you.
No, it's not the guilt. I
would rather move on to
new poof. If I'm cheating, it means I'm not happy with my situation.
Right.
So then I would move on. So, you know, you have to cover yourself with gasoline and oil.
No, you don't. You got to think quicker on your feet.
What, Norton?
Again,
what?
You just go. You go home and you go, I'm sorry, I'm late. I stopped off to do a little bass fishing.
Should I bring tackle? Should I bring a tackle box in the house with me? Should I have done that?
Or say you were shoving caviar into your face. Little fish eggs all over your fingers.
And if the girl's name was Caviar, that would be even funnier. Shoving caviar into my face.
You know,
Yes, Opie.
I got caught cheating once in Buffalo. When I was doing radio up there, because of one can you say
why? Go ahead, write it down.
All right, Norton, just for a minute.
Yeah, sure. I mean, why not? That's what I'm used. What? Yeah, you can say that.
Yeah, I believe you can say that.
I got caught cheating in Buffalo while doing radio.
Yeah,
because my girlfriend at the time found one pubic hair.
Oh, really? Hell, is she Quincy?
One?
Would she pick it up with her tweezers and put it in a bag and send it down to the lab?
It wasn't
and
I folded. And you smiled?
I folded like a cheap tent.
You did?
Folded.
Ass.
Where did she find
it? She pulls the sheets away and there is one pubic hair.
And I guess it was a different...
it was a different color.
Color than... Get out of here.
Nailed.
Wow.
Nailed.
Why were you so bad under pressure? You should have just go, what are you talking about?
How does she identify it as one of those and as someone else's? And wait a minute. What color hair did she have?
Blonde.
And what color hair was the pube in question?
Brown.
Brown. And she was like completely blonde?
Oh, yeah.
Because some girls got the blonde hair up top and then below you're like, hey.
No.
How about you?
Nice.
No.
You blonde?
Yeah.
Look at Norton.
It's not about me, douchebag. It ain't about him.
You could have said it was yours.
Because she knows I'm...
Shaved?
Wow, that's a tricky situation now.
There.
Because there is nothing you can say. Where to come... Did you have a cat?
Eyelash.
Eyelash. No, even eyelash color.
Well, you know what? A piece of thread. You don't break down. Yeah, it's from this girl I took home. You're the worst.
Yeah,
you should have jumped on and said, who the hell did you have in this bed? Look at Rick nodding. Yeah, you're good move. Good move. That's a good ploy.
I folded.
You did. You folded.
Done.
Did you go, did you stutter?
Oh, yeah. The guilt was all over my face.
Awful.
So then I proceeded to do my own threesome, Anthony.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Yeah, but it didn't get quite the publicity-minded.
No.
Two big metropolitan papers.
Well, maybe old Jimmy Norton could have one and then participate in this discussion. Pony up, whores.
All right.
Opie, you sure it was pubic hair and not back hair? Very funny. Rich with a big callback.
Very nice.
To one of Opie's previous relationships.
No, that was a one-timer. That,
right.
That was done to get rid of the old virginity.
The Wookie.
The Wookie.
And Opie had sex with the Wookie.
Bonnie, the hairy back.
Opie.
She didn't have a hairy back. She had a mane. She was beautiful. But she had this weird birth defect, which gave her hair from her neck all the way down to her tailbone in one thin line.
Yeah, it is a weird birth defect. It's called being a silverback. That's awful.
Her name? Davida. No?
No.
Okay,
no.
I thought maybe.
But it was it was quite unusual. Yes.
And God damn.
I was not able to go out with her because of that.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
It turned you off.
Oh, yeah.
Was she hairy anywhere else? Like, was
no,
it
no, she was gorgeous.
A lot of
this
hair?
Girl, I'm not lying.
Really?
Gorgeous.
Did you mention it or did she tell you that
mane.
I had this song?
No, I had to make believe, you know, I was cool with it.
How do you take her to the beach with her chaka stripe?
wow.
I can't.
We have her running down the street after Opie broke up with us. There she goes.
All right, listen, we got to take a break because the legend is here, Anthony.
Oh.
Andrew Dice Clay is outside the studio.
He is he?
What about Rick's tape, though?
I want to talk about Rick.
All right, we could do both.
Come on. Oh, sure we can. With Dice here? There's no talking about anything when Dice is here, except Dice.
We'll do both.
Good luck to you.
Rick brought in a very embarrassing tape today when he was...
See?
When he was doing the...
Hey, I'm here, huh? Hey, Jacob. Hey, jackass.
Hold on.
Okay.
We're going to give you the big intro in a minute here.
Look at your sunglasses are so big. Dice, your sunglasses are gigantic.
They're gigantic. That's so I can put a big fat chick's ass on them.
How you doing, legend?
You're not laughing at Anthony? That was funny.
I didn't even hear him. I'm not in the mood for this.
What is he not in the mood for?
That was funny.
I'm on the radio today. I'm here.
Why?
I'm not comfortable in the studio.
Where do you get those sunglasses?
Your sunglasses are like the windshield of a 747. Look at those things.
Where do you get those?
Hey, let me set myself.
Oh,
you ready?
Yeah, they're big.
I'm all set.
They're big glasses.
They're very big.
I like the blue blockers.
Looks like you're
got it all figured out.
They block out the blue.
It looks like you're going.
You got it all figured out.
It looks like you're going scuba diving. What do you got, goggles?
You got it all figured out.
Goggles are paisan, though.
You got it all figured out.
Yeah.
You got it all figured out.
What's the matter, Dice?
No, I'm all set.
I like your glasses. They're big.
You got it all figured out.
Bigger life, like Dice.
I'm all set now.
You need an air tank on your back with
I'm all set.
Scuba goggles. All right, we'll take a break.
I'm doing Old Navy commercials because that old broad
because you got it all figured out,
because
right?
I got it all
figured
out.
Hey,
you got it all figured out, don't
right.
you?
Dice, you playing where tonight?
Nowhere.
Tomorrow is,
Where's tomorrow?
Where, huh?
Westbury.
I'm trying to give you a good plug here before we
go
break.
Aren't we going to come back? I'm at Westbury tomorrow.
Of course,
tomorrow.
But... All right, Westbury...
They put 200 more tickets on sale for the Beacon.
Oh, boy. Do you know where you're going to be? Westbury tomorrow night, right? On Long
yes,
Island.
Westbury tomorrow night.
Tickets available. And then the Beacon Friday.
Yeah. I was just at Harley-Davidson.
Oh.
At Lexington.
Yeah.
Between 56 and 57.
Oh, boy. That means
I told them I'll be at Westbury...
On my new Harley.
Tomorrow night, which is what date? I don't even know.
It's Thursday.
25th. Oh, you got it all figured out, huh?
I got it figured out.
Is this Dice Cool?
I think we got Dice Cool today.
I just walked in. Don't get me mad.
I'm not getting you mad.
I just walked in.
You got a Pepsi and a cigarette there.
I know this is what you do.
Yeah.
This is all you do.
I'm buying the T-shirt.
This is all I do.
I'm buying the T-shirt.
Yeah.
Over there.
We got a break.
Negotiating a price?
Oh, you got to go on a break?
Yeah.
Well, if you're asking me something.
Because I wanted to give you the plug.
No, I know, but can we do that when we come back?
No.
That's why I was saying.
I'm going to give you another
all set now.
I'm going to give you another plug when you come back.
You know, you were going to come back and give me the intro.
I was gonna.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I haven't seen
intro.
Norton. I haven't seen you
right.
guys.
It's been a while.
You know what I mean? I come in. He
take off.
Already he starts.
Well, they, I did not.
Your sunglasses are a little too
because
big.
Because they're my for who?
For you?
Anybody.
For you. They're
for you. Maybe
big.
For you.
You
like maybe a, for you.
They
like
seem
a,
big.
They seem very large.
They are large.
They're like the Hubble telescope
are large.
Thing.
That's very good. No.
Are you
maybe
able
I
to
wear
see
glasses like him.
Are you able to see
maybe
him?
Give me those glasses.
Are you pointing to Ben?
No, just for a minute.
No, Ben.
Give me the glasses.
Ben doesn't
come
play.
Over there.
He doesn't take his glasses
ben
off.
Doesn't
he doesn't
play.
Take
his glasses
John's.
Off.
Take John's glasses.
No, those are different kinds.
Yeah, those are more John Lennon glasses.
They're little, though. They're little.
Yeah, see how tiny those are?
Now look what happened.
Now let's see. Put them on.
Look what I do.
Look at what Dice does.
Whatever his name is.
It's John's glasses.
Actually, I do want that on.
You look like
wow.
Look like a good
look.
Nutty
put
professor.
This on, and I'm all set.
Now your Dice cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I go back to these glasses.
Yeah.
The little stupid ones.
Right.
Actually, Miss Purdy. Actually, I was just thinking that perhaps I could actually, I thought that would be very nice. You know? Maybe later, once you get it in a test,
I'll come over and sign it.
Yeah, as you go from one glass to another.
Yeah,
right.
then
makes
I
for
go
a great
like
radio
this.
Bit, Dice. Now you change back to the
well,
little
actually,
one.
Actually, the other day, the trick is, actually,
I don't think that'll go.
Now you go back to the big glasses.
Who knows? Forget it.
All right.
Forget it now.
Yeah. Where's the guy? Here,
all right, you're going to do it all
get
day.
Out of here.
What, you're going to do it all day?
All right, come on. I thought we're going to
break.
We've got to
do a break. And then Westbury.
You know, we've got to figure out better ways of doing plugs. I got to be honest.
Yeah?
Because the general populations.
Populations?
Know,
yeah, huh? Yeah?
Like. When you're doing a plug, you gotta, I don't know how
you
to
gotta
do
work it.
It
in subtle?
Yeah, like when I do the Harley thing.
Right.
Harley Davidson.
Oh, that's very subtle.
They gave me a 3% discount to say their name.
What are you getting?
They gave you
they,
that jacket for free.
A
t-shirt?
You don't get nothing for free.
You got that t-shirt for free.
For nothing.
Free.
No, I didn't. I had to pay. They didn't see the couple shirts I stuffed in the bag.
The bag.
You know what I mean?
We're gonna break. We're gonna
talk.
You
hit me.
Why
you going
to
break? I'm
gonna
talk out
now. We gotta go.
Now I'm in the mood for radio.
We're gonna talk.
When I came in, I wasn't in the mood. I had
you
to get set.
Just we'll be back and you can talk.
All right. You know what?
We're gonna
do,
talk
it's
to you.
It's your show. You're gonna do what you're gonna do anyway.
That's right.
You know what I mean?
This young lady's flashing her privates. Whip them out Wednesday with Opie and Anthony.
A bunch of girl ash in their boobs, which is cool.
Wow! The Opie and Anthony Show.
1027 WNEW.
Hey, we're back with the Opie and Anthony Show. Our old pal in the studio. We haven't seen him in a while, Anthony. It's Andrew Dice Clay. We got it all figured out. He's playing Westbury Music Fair tomorrow night.
Nice.
Some tickets still available. And the big show at the Beacon on Friday night with Andrew Dice Clay.
How come I can't hear me now?
And we got...
You're playing games already.
No. We got We got Dice's whole gang in here.
Yeah, actually, you know...
All the annoying people that follow him around.
Oh,
Jesus.
Wait a minute. There it is.
Dice, we already discussed your glasses.
No,
I got to bring up an observation.
It's entourage.
You got an ashtray in front of you and a cigarette, but you stopped smoking.
Yeah, so? Everybody
so
has
what are you
that,
doing?
It's not me. It's Norton. He's taking the ashtray out. Like, because I'm seeing an ashtray, I'm going to start smoking. Because he quit. That's how he works it.
But you still buy cigarettes?
You know, he's one of those smokers that... You know, the minute you quit, you cough at everybody else smoking.
Oh,
and you preach
no,
to them.
No.
Oh, you
no,
shouldn't do that.
True.
Smoking's a bad habit. Yeah.
That's
so
true.
Is wiping your ass with a shower curtain. We're allowed to say that one. That's
yeah, of course. I don't know.
Now Dice, do you still buy cigarettes, though?
Yes.
And you hold them?
Yeah. So what? Don't you do things?
Not like that.
Not
I'm
like
just
that.
Thinking, you know, you either commit to something or not. That's
yeah.
kind of...
It looks kind of silly.
It's not like Dice. I think Dice would go, I don't need cigarettes. And you throw it away like Dice.
I like the cigarettes.
Not like, oh, I'll hold them a while.
You got to understand, I never liked the smoke.
Right.
I was never into smoke.
Right.
Smoke annoys me.
Right.
So I just figured I got to quit lighting them.
Oh, is that it?
But yet I'm getting the same rush.
What
you
dictates
know what I mean?
When you have to throw one away?
But what happens
and get a
is
new
you
one
get
out.
All sogged out.
When it gets soggy?
It gets all sogged out.
It's like when you got to throw
like
your
a
chick
You know what I'm talking about.
I hear
you. Like you got one of those chicks, right? Let's
yeah.
say you've
you've been pinching your helmet all day long.
Right. All
right. Right. So you've built up like 52 full ounces, right?
Okay. That's the
so
hot soup, right?
So you just keep unloading. You just keep unloading, right?
Right.
All of a sudden, she's like a sponge that can't take no more.
Right. Saturated.
What, that's how you work a cigarette.
And then you throw it away.
Same thing.
Why does Kenny have to be behind you?
You know what I mean? I don't know.
Is he protecting you? I mean,
I'm protecting the legend.
No one's going to beat you up around here. Why is he has to stand right next to you like that? He's making us all uncomfortable.
Yeah,
I'm his bodyguard.
Do me a favor.
All right, there you go.
Why is he making you uncomfortable?
Because he's all big and stuff. He could beat anyone up in here.
Yeah.
Oh, look, we're all friends here. Everybody's happy. Norton's here.
Yeah.
Just did town hall this week. Did a great job. Wasn't it this week?
Yeah, it was April. Last night.
Yeah, when was it? Gee,
that?
We all forgot the date. You didn't say it enough times. And Dice turned us on to Jimmy Norton. There.
That's right. Our little Jimmy Norton was opening up for Dice quite a while.
Now look at him.
And it's all working out for everybody.
Now he's all set.
He's all set, Dice. Sure.
Now I got Jason Robito.
Jason, hi, how are you?
Yeah, he's my new opener.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
Does he talk?
Does he talk?
Yeah, he does good. You got to see him.
Well, nodding really works on the radio.
You know what?
He doesn't
care what he does. What do you got embarrassed?
I
want
to see what he sounds like.
Why can't you What do you mean? What's he supposed to do?
Say hi.
I told him before we came up here, you guys don't like when performers do bits. Like, this is like just what happens.
No, this is no bit, but I want the guy to say hi. We got a lot of people.
Hear what his voice sounds like, maybe.
The people want to hear what the guy that's opening up for Dice sounds like. That's
got a lot of personality.
He's got a personality.
Oh, he's got a lot of personality. You see what I mean?
They're doing bits,
actually. We're not doing any bits.
What
does that mean? You always say that. They're doing bits.
And that's not...
I just said the guy's got a lot of personality.
And that's not...
A lot of personality.
He's
that's
not the guy.
Personality. Personality. Walk. Personality.
That's not the guy that opens up for
you, though.
That's not the guy.
It's not
the
point.
The point is,
that's the weird-looking guy.
I don't want him to do his bits.
He's a weird-looking guy.
Because, what do you mean he's a weird-looking guy?
He's a little...
It's Titanium Todd.
Yeah, I know. It's Todd.
You know
like
how that
Todd.
Is.
Yeah.
How does he feel that he was second fiddle to Rich Voss?
Oh, nice.
Hey, how do you feel you were second fiddle to Rich Voss?
What does that mean?
Dice wanted Rich Voss to open up.
You know,
up
I actually forgot I even invited him to open for
really?
Me. Yes.
And then what?
And don't get me wrong. I like Rich.
Yeah.
But if I don't see him or hear him, I never, ever think of him. Ever. Like if nobody ever brought him up.
Right.
And like 20 years from now, they go, oh, Rich Voss just came out to L.A. Oh, yeah, I remember that. I forgot that guy was alive.
Right. That's how his audience feels, sure.
That's right.
Right
Rich Voss.
He leaves the stage, they forget about
it. He couldn't do it or something because of...
He shot a pilot.
He shot a movie for VH1 about... Some went on with Bob Hope and Bing Crosby.
No, it's a some pilot he's got
they
for a
did
show.
Things the way men did comedy back then when comedy was done the way men did it. Like dinosaurs. I hear me.
We all hear you.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Like yesterday I was having breakfast over there like... And today I'm having the same kind of breakfast, almost like that breakfast happened at that moment. The way you would have things done back then.
Right.
Like men did it.
Right.
All right.
Go ahead. Hey, Hemi.
Why hasn't Happy Face said anything yet?
He's listening the way he used... Remember the way he used to come up here
right.
back then?
Yeah.
Like years ago.
He was very scared.
The way men... respected other men to say what they had to say, like their piece.
Right.
That's that then.
Yeah, exactly. Happy Face, you want to say anything?
When the legend speaks, people listen.
Oh, is that it? I can't believe
it. No, I was just making a statement.
All right. I understand.
And can we have Club Soda Kenny say something? We haven't heard him in a while because I think you kicked him out of your entourage.
Yeah, what happened? Was there a falling out, Kenny?
There was no falling out. Yeah, it was the same thing like Rich Voss.
I was very sick.
You were sick?
Yeah.
What'd you have?
Don't talk about me. Let's talk about Andrew.
You know what? Number one, we were talking about Rick.
Did you see him?
I'm not done talking about Rick.
Smile as beautiful as the sunrise.
You can't say as beautiful as the sunrise?
His smile is as beautiful as the sunrise.
Look at him and like to show him
and
the
then
smile.
He smiles.
Arches are as strong as the Verrazano Bridge.
His arches? Yeah. How have you known about Dice's arches? Like, how do you even know that?
Who doesn't?
Do you want to get with him?
He is the American legend.
Are you gay for him? Is that it?
I will do anything he told me to.
Oh, my God. And how do you feel about that, Dice?
Put your jacket on. Get on. Wait outside.
What?
How do you feel that he would do anything
for you?
Open
your mouth to me.
He would play with the balloon knot.
Yeah, he would do anything for you. That means, like, treat you like, you know, you could treat him like a woman.
What are you guys, got a thing with faggots? All of a sudden.
All of a sudden?
You know, that people do. Excuse me. Protesting outside this show.
I didn't know you had it all figured out. You know, they're entitled to love, too.
We don't mind. Yeah.
You know what I mean? So what? They're faggots. So what? They don't know how sick they is. You know what I mean?
They need a good...
You know, like all we were doing, driving down here. Look at her. Look at that ass. Look at a boom. Look at this. You know what I mean? They're looking at... Oh, look at him.
Right.
You know what I mean? Look at the way he cuts his burns. Look at... You know what I mean?
You had a problem with the gay people of...
I used to give them publicity.
No, they would
protest. That's the difference.
They would protest outside your shows, Doc.
Because they didn't get it, obviously.
They didn't like the way you would talk about the gays.
I would talk about the trans testicles, the bi-sickness that they have, that they can't decide. You know, it was things like
you
that.
You would talk about their rises.
No. I would talk about the different kind of fagatitos that they put out there today.
They put
like
out?
Like years ago, they had like old school fagatitos.
Right.
The kind, I like a boy and that's that. And I stay inside my house in the closet with him. And we pinch helmets.
Okay.
Today... You got the ones that dress up like Sissy Mary's there.
Yeah.
With a dress and the other thing that they wear, you know, through the split of the cul-de-sac.
Okay.
To separate them.
Right.
And then you got the ones, you know, that just sicken me.
You're out of your mind.
Yeah. Like dinosaurs, I like them. Old school faggots.
The old school ones.
The kind of faggot that said, I'm not a faggot. I really do like girls. Next thing you know, he's wearing mommy's panties.
Okay.
You know, today they come out, I'm out of the closet. You know what? Get in.
You don't like
get
him
back.
You don't like him out of the closet.
No, it's not that. I don't, you know, like, believe me, I could just drop pint after pint all day.
Of hot soup.
It's what I do.
Okay.
It's all I do. You know what I mean? That's what I get up for, do that.
Yes, nice.
But, you know, I don't walk around all day going, you know, oh, bend over and do that. And then I do the other thing, and then hot soup. Hot soup! You know what I mean? Mr. President, hot soup! Hot soup! Mr. President, did he say call me too? Did he say saw me too? Hot soup! You know what I mean? I don't do that.
Right.
I do it at the direct moment of impact. That's how I work.
Are you having a nervous breakdown?
But no. But these guys are out there going, I'm not afraid to say I like other men. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's not right.
It's not right.
It just doesn't work.
All right. Are you being Dice cool right now?
No, I'm explaining a theory.
Oh, you're being Dice
explaining. I'm explaining a theory. Like, I got no problem. You're with a chick, right?
A theory.
You're with a chick.
Yeah.
And you want to explore the other half of her.
What do you mean, the back half?
Yeah.
All right.
It's like, you know, the front is turned to mush because you pummel it constantly.
Okay.
You know what I mean? You just pummel it. It's an assault. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, Todd, what do you weigh? Because he's very like
about 97 pounds.
No, all right, so he's like, no, you're like 115, 120,
about
right?
About 120.
All right, but then picture a 120 just smacking into the center of you with everything you got.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? So it's going to get splatted.
Right, splatted.
So now what you do, you don't like force yourself on her. You turn her over with her eyes all jacked up.
Yeah.
You think you're dumb?
You what?
You think you're dumb?
You're dumb?
You're gum?
You're dumb.
You dip with
you know,
your
like
thumb.
You dip a chip into sauce. You know, like you're in the Italian restaurant. Right. You take a little bread, you dip it into. You think you're dumb?
You're dumb.
And you dip.
You dip?
You're dumb.
What is that? What does she like this?
No, but I'm saying, fagatitos do the same thing. It's just wrong.
To dip.
Because you don't have that other crap down there.
That turns
that you can
mush.
At least go, oh, it's really a chick.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like when you start feeling sick about taking your thumb and dipping it in the thing.
Yeah.
You see that, you know, on the hair, you know.
Right,
the,
it's still a girl.
You know, the chuck steak, whatever they call it.
You're all right with it because you know she's a chick.
Well, that's what
gotcha.
I'm saying.
But gotcha. Does that mean, because I'm getting a little something from you that maybe when you're dipping, you're feeling a little gay, even if it's a girl.
No.
That you have to reassure yourself by looking at
it. No, because
it's
pushed on us so often.
Yeah.
Because I studied this.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
What school did you study at?
Then? I'm old school. I studied like old school style.
Back in the old days.
In the old days.
He's doing that look again, Ed. Yeah, yeah.
And I'm like, taking my thumb.
Yeah.
Dang.
Yeah.
And I'm like, dang, wriggle me now.
And pummel.
And I says to her like that.
Yeah.
And then she says, I'm all set. I said, are you sure there? And she says again, I'm all set.
Yeah. And?
That's what I say.
Yeah, that's what you say. When you dip.
I got to come up with words on this show.
Well, dip is good.
You know what's funny? I hear the filthiest things ever.
Yeah.
On the show, when I call it.
Yeah.
The minute I get in, well, you can't say that. You can't say
no.
that.
Well, you don't understand how to put it in terms that you
can't say.
You don't understand to put it in terms that you can say these things.
You know what I mean?
You can say anything.
Can't say those things.
You could say anything as long as you put it in the
right
context.
Unless it's like Star Blaster, like the movie.
Star Blaster?
Yeah, that big movie.
I know Brain Smasher.
Orange Clock.
We like the Brain Smasher.
No,
Brain
I'm not talking about
was good,
that.
Dice.
He doesn't want to talk
about the movie's
about,
out now.
Talking about Brain Smasher. That was good. You were a cop in that, right?
Yeah, whatever.
Kind of renegade cop.
Yeah, 20 years ago. What are you talking about? I'll come over
the
there.
Movie.
I'll choke you to death.
I like
give me something to hit him with.
What? No, that answer.
Really? I'll smack you in the face with
I
the
like
answer.
It.
I'll just do it. I don't even
we
care.
We enjoyed the Brain Smasher.
But I'm not talking about that.
Brought it up.
No, I said Brain Clock.
And I said Brain Smasher.
The thing where they go faster than one guy.
I don't know what you're talking
Everything
about.
Everything stops. It's a kid's movie.
Time Stoppers.
Who'd you, stinks.
Who'd you play in that?
Or... Stinks. It says like Back to the Future.
Who'd you play
they
in that?
They should put it back in the can and tell the director to wipe his ass with it. That's how bad it was. If I ever see him, I'm going to punch him in the face. Make me spend the money. Well, I wouldn't hit him.
One Night at McCool's was
I would
great.
Just tell him, you know.
You were very
you
good in that.
How do they say something's like something?
One Night at McCool's.
Every movie.
That was good.
Every movie
that was
in the
good.
World. Wait a minute. Every movie in the world, when you go and buy like a billboard or a poster, you ever notice there's a best. Every movie's best movie of the year.
Right.
A must see movie. And they all stink.
Really?
Why don't they put one sign that says, you see this movie over here? They'd say, like, it stinks.
That sucks.
Everybody would go see it. It would be the biggest of the year.
Guys, they put
this movie is garbage.
They put
don't
good,
check it out.
They put the good
please,
movie thing
don't
on.
Don't waste your money. Shut up.
Failing.
Come over there.
No, don't throw
really,
things
I'm in a bad mood.
Hey, what happened to your cigarette? Were
we're
you done
talking.
With that one? Now he flicks them at people.
Yeah.
He flicks it at me.
That's dangerous.
When they're lit, when they're not lit, what's going to happen?
Ouch.
Tobacco stain.
I got to have another one now.
Now he pulls out another one.
Cigarette. A net. You get what I just did?
Saturday Night Fever.
That's right. You see, I threw that in.
That was good.
And Ned,
that's
you,
right,
you do some Travolta.
All right, I'm bored with it.
I did it already. How long are you going to do it? 20 minutes? I did a perfect impression, not even thinking about it.
I did one
came
line.
Out with it.
He did one
you
line.
Know what I mean? Threw it at you. Thrilled you, and then stupefaction face over here.
Nah.
Besides, now I'm going to do 10 more minutes.
First
of
all, and that cigarette was Double J, and you were doing Travolta, so
that's
you
right.
screwed it up.
It doesn't matter.
He
what do you mean?
Say in that cigarette.
What? Am I paid to know
he
who
didn't
says
say
what line?
In that cigarette.
I do the line I want.
Didn't say it.
No, but
you
I take the
up.
Character.
Oh, so then
do
you
the perfect impression
of, a, right. of another guy
right,
who was
so,
doing it in the movie.
So say cigarette and that is Double J.
No, I don't do that impression.
Well, what do?
You do that impression.
That's right.
I just do Travolta going, come on, I'm bored.
So I didn't say I'm doing Travolta. That was Double J.
No, it was.
It was not.
It just sounded a lot like Travolta. Don't you guys get it?
What other,
not at all.
What other impressions, Dice?
What else? You
Now I'll do Travolta.
Okay.
Doing the same line.
Let's do it.
Oh, cigarette, the net.
You're going to do it all day.
No, what I'm saying is, first I did Double J doing the line, and I do Travolta doing the line.
But Travolta never did the line. That's what I'm saying.
But he did it here.
Oh,
right
now.
You're
rewriting the script.
Well, what do I got to know it exact? You know, when people...
He's got 1,000 lines that you could have done in the movie.
Donnie. Don't talk, Donnie. You look like me. You dress like me, Donnie. It's what I do, Gail.
That's very good.
It's all I do, Gail. You see what I did? But I did me. Like Pacino doing me just now, I did.
Really?
Right, Happy, what'd you think of that?
It was wonderful.
I love everything you just said.
Right.
Jason Robito.
There's adoration there.
My new opening act.
I know, but he doesn't talk.
Because he's a little afraid.
Does he do impressions? Does he do any impressions? You do any impressions?
You do an impression.
What do you do?
We have the fuego, I'm out.
What?
You got to hear it when he really does it.
What the hell is that? Wow.
Did you hear that?
Was that Scarface?
Perfect.
Yeah?
Do it again.
Let's hear a little.
Brenda Fuego Ramo.
Yeah, that's not bad.
They're going to love him at Westbury.
Yeah, huh?
Yeah.
All right, we got to take a break.
What do you think?
Good.
He's not talking.
Well, he's saving it up.
He's getting ready for the show tomorrow night at Westbury.
That's the goof. When that the King of the View didn't show up, Voss.
Yeah, the King of the View.
Do you remember that?
Yes.
Remember how awful that was? Opie. You're the one that called me and said, did you see Voss?
I didn't see Voss on this.
Oh, it was terrible. It was awful.
Well, you watched the
video. You know what? You should have actually been fined from the Comics of America for going on a show and doing that kind of thing. I like, didn't understand.
Is there a Comics of America that could fine?
Unless he just wanted to get that close to Joy's big boobs. You know what I mean?
You watched The View?
I give it that little douche right on the...
You watched that?
You like The View?
You. What's wrong with The View?
It's for fags.
He was on The View.
What do you mean it's for fags?
It's
what
for
do you say?
House of Wax.
They're going to get married.
I can even understand being on it more than watching it.
I watch it every day.
Are you a house fag? Ain't right.
Dice it gets me angry.
You're ruining your image.
No.
Telling people
me,
you watch
you don't
The
understand.
View. How does it
gets
get you
me
angry? What angers you?
Because you watch shows today. Let's say.
The fat one?
No, listen. Forget about the fat. Fat could always be changed. Ugly. It's forever. That's the way it works. Like when you watch Sex in the City with them mutts, right? You know, no boobs, no butts, but yet they're successful.
Right.
That can never happen for a woman. You don't have a top or a bottom, and you're making money? It can never happen. Now, shows like Three's Company, remember that?
Oh, right. Yeah.
Suzanne Summers,
nice.
Big boobs.
Nice.
Your sort of shorts, you know, splitting the thing there.
Right, the camel toe.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
You know, the front bumper.
The front bumper,
you know what I mean?
Sure.
You saw that. She had the hair and pigtails, always acting stupid.
Right.
You know, believable.
Shut your mouth.
Oh, no, who's this? Frenchie.
How you doing?
It's Frenchie, Dice.
I want to say hello to the Jim Norton, the man of the show today.
Okay.
How you doing, Jim? You're the legend. Oh!
It's a French Dice.
Dice, how you doing? You fat bastard.
Yeah, let me tell you something. Why don't you shut your mouth? All right? Let me tell you something. Why don't you shut your mouth and give him some respect? Why don't you get off the phone and show your face down here? I'll put my boot in your throat. You understand me? Frenchie, you faggot. Hey, you French people ever win a war? You faggot. You're a faggot. You're a faggot. You're a faggot. Go live between your mother's legs. That's where you belong. You're a faggot. You're a faggot. You don't ever make him a legend. He's a legend. He's a star. He's playing the Beacon Theater Friday night. He's playing Westbury. Not you, you French faggot. You're a faggot. What do you do besides cook snails? You're a faggot.
I want to talk to the legend.
What do you got to get? The guy's just trying to say hello.
That's disrespect. It's disrespectful.
What do you got? I don't like him either, Andrew.
Well, that's what they do. That's their little...
I saw him at Norton's show.
That's their fun.
Oh, you met the Frenchie.
Yeah.
At Norton's show.
Yeah, he wet his pants when he seen me.
Hey, Frenchie.
That's why he's a big shot on the phone.
What happened when you met Kenny? Hey, Frenchie, what happened when you met Club Soda Kenny?
I actually like Frenchie. I don't know.
He was a very nice guy, actually.
Yeah, you better say that.
Yeah, he'll kick your ass.
You better say that. Well, is it true that you wet yourself when he came up to you?
No, actually, I did the backdoor action there, you know. It went all over my pants.
He's French dice.
I really don't see a problem with
this
guy.
French dice.
It's French dice.
Give us some more dice, so Frenchie.
Wait, I want to hear it. French
I'm not gonna do it all day.
How long is he gonna do it for now?
Yeah,
you got mad at me for doing cigarette.
I remember that.
But he could do this for
I didn't get mad how long
you
were
hours.
Doing it. I got mad because you didn't do the right character.
But what line do you need?
I don't know.
You know,
I'm
here
it's
and
all the way. Hey, I'm bored with it, all right?
I'm bored with it, right? Get rid of this guy. I'm just bored with him.
All right, Frenchie.
I'm bored with it.
What,
you know, I had my dance in 2001,
right.
and I thought maybe we could dance together. You remember me, Tony Manel? We looked at, I look at a guy and record him every second, and he gets to reaching for Ninja. Oh, I know the type. I know the type. And I guess it starts with a C, Mr. B. Go scratch your AIDS. See, I'm perfect. Hey, without trying.
Perfect. We're going to take a break.
Yes. Without even trying.
We got Dice in the studio, Westbury Music Fair tomorrow night, then the Beacon Theater on Friday. I
absolutely.
Think. We're going to the Beacon Theater show.
See,
on
that
Friday.
Sounds like a professional plug.
Who
that
cares?
Doesn't...
They don't care.
Know.
Rip 'em out Wednesday.
Oh, man. Monday
Wow. The Opie and Anthony Show.
I love that.
The Opie and Anthony Show. 1027 WNEW.
Yeah, we're hanging with Andrew Dice Clay today. It's the Opie and Anthony Show. Dice playing in the Westbury Music Fair tomorrow night.
Yeah.
And the Beacon Theater Friday. We'll be at the Beacon Show on Friday with Dice.
Oh, yeah.
Just, what's that put out there?
They have approximately 300 more tickets they just put on sale for the Beacon Theater this morning.
Thank you, Happy Face.
Nice. Welcome, sir.
I said to Dice, it looks like he lost some weight, and he looks like he's in shape.
And then
he gets insulted. And then the next thing
because
I know,
because I'm an Adonis, I'm gorgeous. How do you even say any of that?
He's ready to show me his I don't know what were you going to show us?
A little thing.
All of a sudden, he's pulling his shirt up so we can get a closer look.
Well, Anthony was getting all excited. I saw he started popping.
I said, you're working out there,
he started feeling a little blood flow.
Yeah, it was. Not as much as when you played a Tony Schlongini in Wacko. But, you know, because you looked good then.
Where are you pulling this stuff out? Tony Schlongini. I think I was 14 when I did Tony Schlongini.
Tell me he's lying.
Why? No, that's the first movie ever.
Yeah. Dice's first movie. Oh, come on,
Tony Schlongini.
I know your career. Give us a line as Tony Schlongini.
All right. You want a line as Tony Schlongini?
Sure. Yeah.
Really? You really want it?
Yeah.
Line as
Let's see it one.
Wait, I got to think of Tony Schlongini.
It's not a net cigarette.
Hey, Rosie.
Remember
that part?
No.
When I did that?
Not at all.
That was the beginning. I come down the stairs.
Yeah.
And they say, everyone's talking about him.
Yeah.
You could sing the song.
I don't know the song offhand.
Tony Schlongini.
I haven't seen the movie in quite some time there, Dyson. It wasn't
so
one
why you bringing
like,
it
stuck
up?
In my head.
Well, why not? Why are you bringing it up?
Because I'm a fan of your career. I kind of know one of the movies.
You know, there's a lot of people that love Tony Schlongini.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's the line then? Give us a line.
When I say to the guy, you know, I'm going to punch you in the head or something like that.
And it sounded like Travolta?
Yes, because he was Tony Schlongini.
Okay, right.
Which was a takeoff of Travolta.
Right.
He doesn't remember Tony Schlongini.
Like a takeoff of Tony Manero, kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where he goes, and what do? You got a 2001 on your Friday night, and you blow all your money, right? Yeah, that's right.
Very good.
Well, you got some Stairway to the Stars? That's Tony Schlongini.
Oh, no, it's Tony Manero.
Only it was written better.
Yeah?
No, it's Tony Schlongini. That's a lot of lines.
So you didn't
similar.
Change any of the lines then?
No, there were a lot of
Tony
lines.
Tony Schlongini and Tony Manero. No, same script.
It was just very similar.
But that's the same line.
No.
Dance at 2001?
No, what? It just happened.
You
I
have
don't
a
know.
Good, doofy the, friend with big shoes that jumps off the Verrazano?
No.
That didn't happen in that movie?
No.
Yeah?
But what happened? He goes, you see, now you're pig.
Oh, well, he didn't say pig in the Saturday Night
Fever. In the PG version, my friend.
It's pig.
And also in the Tony Schlongini version. Because it was a PG movie.
Oh, yeah, so they had to say pig.
Yeah.
All right.
When she goes with Double J. Only it was Triple J.
With all of them, yeah.
In the Tony Slonghini movie.
Oh, was it?
They go, you see that? Now you pig.
Did you have a priest brother that left the priesthood?
No, he was a father, like.
He'll go back. He'll go back.
Yeah. No, he won't. No, he won't. Yes, he won't. No, he won't. Yes, he will. No, he won't. You see that? Now you got two garbage kids.
Garbage, but he said piece of S.
No, that was in the R-rated.
Oh, the PG and Tony Slonghini?
That's right. And Tony Slonghini said the same thing. Don't touch the hair. He always hits my hair, and it hurts.
I noticed our Club Soda Kenny's not laughing.
Yeah, what's the matter, Kenny?
What's wrong, Kenny?
You heard this before, you look bored.
Any comments
are you enjoying this?
About how terrific he was, like in Night Patrol or Casual Sex?
Well, a lot of casual
he'll
sex,
get to that.
Course.
He'll get to that.
I'll get to it, maybe.
Or maybe Anthony wants to do his terrific impression of Julia Child.
Hey, what's wrong with Julia Child?
No, I love it. I've been waiting to hear it.
We kind of enjoy the Julia Child.
Yeah.
But you're not smiling when Dice is performing.
Yeah. I'm in awe.
What's wrong?
He's in awe. Again. Again.
Yeah, right. Well, not Joe wants to say hi. Hold on. Joe.
What about Anthony with the Tom Brokenjaw?
That's a lot of fun, isn't it?
Mike.
It's not about us today. It's about
the legend.
They can, like, do dueling impressions.
That's not about us now today. It's about Andrew.
I'm glad you realize that.
That's about Dice. Joe, what's up? It's not about you, Kenny.
Hey, Dice. Dice?
Balloon, not Joe.
Dice,
baby.
Is Dice there?
Hey, hold on. All right, I'm all set.
Hey, Dice, are you feeling all right? Because your voice sounds different.
Yeah, I'm all set.
Oh, boy.
It's a little screwy. I gotta take
some.
You're
going to be all right for the shows?
No, I should be all right. Wait a minute.
Need some tea with honey?
Yeah, a little tea.
Little tea.
Donnie. Let me test it. Donnie.
It'll work.
Yeah, it'll work, right?
I want to hear more Scarface from your guy over there.
Oh, the opener?
Yeah.
Jason Robito.
Yeah. He seems more relaxed now.
Yeah, I'm all right now.
He might be ready to talk.
Everybody in it?
Yeah. You want to hear?
No, you don't say that. That's not how you do radio. Because there'll be a million emails in 1 second go, that's the new opener? What do you want to hear? You don't work like that.
Let's do it.
That's it.
What you want? Brianto fuego, Brianto Mariano, Brianto Resto, Brianto Fuego, Brianto Mariano, Brianto Mariano, Brianto Padero, Brianto Fuana.
All right. So it works. That's good, right?
Yeah, okay.
Remember
it sounded like Spanish.
It is Spanish.
Nah, that can't
be. Have any Puerto Rican call here. They'll say exactly what
that's
it just said.
That's not real Spanish. Use their phone card for
different.
That.
Do your other one.
You want to hear? La faga, I don't know anything. See that?
At least you got somebody that is a lot like Voss. To open for you.
They'll loosen up. Look at they just found a new target in you.
That's all right.
You're fine.
Don't ever let them hurt you.
And what's
he's
wrong?
No Dice as Kurt Jake. In Private Resort. That got me going.
How do you know that?
Why?
You want to know, I don't care that you know Private. You know the character. I didn't even
Kurt.
Remember.
Kurt. That's a great character.
Kurt.
I don't remember. A lot of personality in that.
Personality? I mean, you're going to get the cup of them all along.
You don't remember being Kurt?
Why would I remember him?
Give me a line from Kurt.
All right, let me do Kurt for you.
All right, this is Kurt. It's Kurt.
All right, because I was with Johnny Depp, if you remember.
Oh, big star,
and,
sure.
Okay. So I come over to him, and I say like this. You know how all those girls are down 2001? I'm with my girl. Maybe you let me use your room, right?
No, wait, that's Kurt. It sounds like Tony Slonghini.
No, but it was a takeoff.
Doing Tony.
See, I got hired. Yeah. No, I got hired.
Yeah.
Because they saw what I did as Slonghini.
Your work as Slonghini.
So they expected.
Right.
Like the same persona.
Yeah.
Like
that's
when
why they
Travolta
hired.
Went from Fever to Grease.
It's pretty much the same
guy. Same guy.
They just put him back
in
line.
So now I'm stuck in this persona.
Yeah. You broke out of that, though, later on.
And then I had a fight with Hector Elizondo.
Yeah?
And I says like this to him. Donnie.
Now, that don't sound like Kurt.
No. He says to me.
Oh, okay.
Oh, no, he called me Kurt. Kurt. Doesn't that sound like him?
Yeah, just like it.
Kurt.
Yeah.
Do you know what I did today, Kurt? No, I don't know. You'll have no idea, my friend. Well, you got to explain it to me, because... You know, because I'm here with my partner.
Yeah.
You know, and then Johnny Depp walks in and goes,
right.
Yeah, I can't let you use my room.
Is that Sylvester Stallone?
No.
Why does that sound like Johnny Depp?
Because at that time, Depp had more of a character going, like a Rocky Balboa.
I don't understand. No.
You know what I mean?
I don't remember that phase.
What do you mean you don't remember?
I don't remember that Johnny Depp phase of being like Sly.
When he was all bulked up, before he shredded, before he did Jump Street.
Before Jump Street?
And he was playing all those parts. You know, like that Stallone type of thing. Like,
I completely don't know.
You know, I gotta go with that girl. You know, you shouldn't.
Johnny Depp.
Yeah, it's exactly.
Yeah?
Perfect.
I don't remember
exact
that.
Line.
All right.
And I'm going, no, you gotta get out of the room and give them one of them condominiums.
Right.
You know, so I could go with the girl. Oh, but he's not saying right in between.
Yeah. And he's then he jumps off the Verrazano Bridge wearing the big platform shoes. Goes,
why didn't you call me, Tony?
There was no bridge in the
Tony,
movie.
Tony, you didn't call me.
All right, Bobby. Bobby, come off the bridge. You're making me very nervous, Bobby.
Look, Tony, I'm dancing. Look, Tony. No, look at me, Tony. No, look
Bobby,
at me.
Bobby,
look at me, Tony.
Bobby,
look at me,
come
Tony.
In the car. Bobby, come in the car.
Tony, look at
we
me.
We can talk about Bobby.
Look at me, Tony.
Bobby.
You didn't call me.
Why would you learn that?
Well,
me? Why would you even bother to learn
I've
that?
I've seen the movie.
You
see it.
You know, I had a car accident with that guy.
Did you? No way. The guy with the platform shoes.
That dummy.
Did he come out?
Why did you hit me, Dice? Why did you hit?
You know. Right. I actually stopped my car because I saw he was on the wrong side of the street.
Yeah.
I didn't know it was him.
Right.
I just saw somebody coming out, so I actually stopped. And this moron kept going and just bashed in the front of a Trans Am I had.
Yeah.
And he gets out of the car, and I see who it is. I go, Bobby. And I went home. Yeah. I actually went home, got my video camera, because the cars are screwed up anyway.
Yeah.
And we, like, redid it.
Redid it?
And made, like, a movie out of it.
Wait, he came back?
No, I didn't let him leave.
Oh, wait, you had to leave to get your camera, then you came back.
I lived around the corner. I had to go get the video camera.
And he waited.
Yeah. Well, where's he going? The car's destroyed.
Where was this, Brooklyn?
No, it was out in L.A.
Oh.
So then I called this guy up. I go, you got to take care of the damage. And he's telling me, I got no money. I was actually on my way to Palm Springs to pick up the car. I had a car, his real car. That was a rented car.
See, that part of the story I don't care now.
No, but I'm just saying, I got a whole movie with Bobby.
Oh, okay. I want to see that.
I made that's a feature film, basically.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, Bobby and Dice. I get Bobby.
Bobby and Dice.
Yeah. I'm going, Bobby, come on. Come out of the car and talk to me, Bobby. But why did you learn that impression?
I did just, I've always thought it was
do
funny.
Do it again.
It was
let me
oh, ask. You're not getting me like that.
I just want to see.
No. I did it already.
And
that's
what it. He does. He does
do
a different scene.
No. You look at your video you made.
Do you remember?
That's it.
Father, when he says to Tony's father,
she loves to taste the communion wafers.
But that's not how he says it.
Yeah, he was doing it like Double J.
No, do it like...
What?
Do it like him.
I'm not going to do it now. Now I'm not doing it.
I don't want to start yelling. I need my
hey,
quote.
Hey, father.
That's not what he says. All right, you want me to dance with you? Would you be happy if I danced?
Very good, but you're going to do it all day. We don't have much time.
No,
yet.
I do a perfect impression of course of that's Kurt. That's Tony Slanghini.
Tony Slanghini.
You know, and then I changed it up a little.
Right, you changed it up a little.
Yeah, I got
that's
like
why you're
too.
The legend. All right, Dice, we got to
that's why you're the legend.
Yeah. And we got to take a break, and then we're going to wrap up with Dice and get out of here and stuff.
Well, yeah, you can.
You mean I got to wait?
Yeah, just a couple.
A short break.
We're going to do a very short break.
How short?
Let's like go 3-4 minutes tops.
It won't be long.
All right.
And
have another cigarette.
Yeah.
Sop up another cigarette.
Yeah, that one's getting a little too wet. Get a new one.
All it's right. Juicy.
Dice play Westbury Music Fair tomorrow night and the Beacon Theater on Friday.
Right.
We're going to the Beacon Theater show.
Dice, baby. Dice checking in from over here.
Dice, baby. Oh, it's so nice.
Gotta love the dice.
Over here now.
got your legs.
Okay, terrific.
Don't just stare at it, eat it.
Just look at me like a chick with balls.
Oh, nice,
nice,
baby.
He's a jerk, it's plain to see.
Nice, nice, baby. He's a scumbag. Nice, nice. I'm over here. Nice, nice.
I'm good like that, my friend. You're full of crap.
Oh!
Look what we did to you again.
Opie and Anthony Show,
1027
WNEW.
And we're back to the Opie and Anthony Show. Hey, 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 Andrew Dice Clay in the studio. If you weren't so self-centered, yeah. Dice, you would know that Devin played Buzz, the older brother, in a Home Alone movie.
I just don't watch those kind of movies.
What those kind
of
movies?
You've never seen Home Alone and Home Alone 2?
You have kids.
No,
stop
it's
it.
Not what I do.
It's not all you do.
He's a nice guy. Good luck with it.
Good luck with it. What year was that, 12 Devin?
12 years ago.
12 years ago. He was a real little kid back then. He's grown up now.
Oh.
He still gets checks from it, though, which is nice.
So, and, it, you know, he looks a little different now, Dice.
He's still a young guy. What are you, like 23, 24?
25.
But he was a kid.
25?
Yes, he was 25. A kid in that movie.
What do you mean, a kid? Like a baby kid?
I was 13 when
he was 13.
And what, did your parents force you into these kind of movies?
that was a hit movie. It was one of the highest grossing movies.
One of the hottest comedies of all time.
Yeah.
No, I know.
You don't remember little Macaulay Culkin?
No, I know. He's that creepy kid, right?
I guess you can put it that way. You got that right.
Doesn't he wear a top hat? He dances on Broadway.
What? Who the hell are you thinking
with,
about?
With Tommy Tune, he does that whole thing.
That's Jiminy Cricket.
You're thinking of the black kid, the tap dance kid.
I didn't realize Norton was still here.
I don't understand Norton. Every time he won't talk.
He gets really scared when you're around.
I love when he talks.
He's a legend. What am I going to do? Interrupt?
But why not?
Why would I?
Why not?
It's rude.
Don't you think I'm proud of you? I haven't seen you since you've had all this newfound success.
Of course, you're on the show.
Stop. I don't want to hear that.
Does he have to give you a tribute?
No,
Dice? Does he pay you a tribute?
You want to know the truth? I don't even care about that.
Yeah?
Yeah.
No?
No. That's
yeah?
You know what?
No?
It's nice that I was part of his career. That's all.
Yeah.
He's doing great.
Hey, nice.
Hey, I don't care.
Yeah.
I'm leaving.
Oh, take it easy, man.
What do you mean you're
enjoy
leaving?
The game.
Let's talk to this guy.
He's
got to
go.
From,
all right. No, we'll talk.
Macaulay Culkin's friend.
You do what you want. I got to go.
Oh, he's got to go.
What
take it easy,
Al. Where are you going?
He's going to the Islander game.
He's got to go to the Islander game.
He's got a playoff game.
That's pretty important to
me
today.
Oh, that's right. The ball game there.
It's not a ball game. It's a
hockey.
Puck game.
It's very exciting.
Game with a puck.
Yeah, but it's
not. Islanders are in the playoffs for the first time in 8 years.
You got to get it in the basket.
No, it's a net.
It's a net.
You are one of the most self-centered people. You know nothing about anything else in life except you.
What do you think those guys would show up if they wasn't getting paid?
You got to open yourself up.
Do you think they would show up?
What, the hockey players?
You don't get a check, you don't show up. That's the way it goes.
You think they know who Dice is?
What do I care?
They probably do, though. See,
you
got to open up and get to know about
them. I'm not saying I don't like hockey. I like all them guys.
I'm going.
All right.
Where you going? Wait a minute.
He's got to go. He'll go. It's okay.
This guy.
Oh,
have a good time, all right?
He's got to go to the hockey game.
I'll see you tomorrow.
He's fine.
Good.
There he goes.
See you at the Beacon Friday.
All right. Good for me, then.
The Beacon Friday.
I'm all set.
You all right with that?
All right, that's my mind.
You feel bad that he left? Now, you're going over there? Oh, boy. This could be trouble. You're self-centered, Dice. You got it. You know what? I think you'd be wise to learn about things.
I even got my own control man.
Learn about things.
I got my own control man.
Yeah, but you don't know what it is.
I don't have to control.
Don't push the buttons because you don't know what the hell they do.
No, now I'm over here.
You don't know what they do.
You got to work it.
Don't touch that.
I'm not touching
a thing. You're playing bowling sounds.
It just snares the power involved.
You know,
for such a self-centered guy. In the meantime, now me and yous are doing an interview with Macaulay Culkin's friend.
No,
Devin.
You know what this is like? The episode of Star Trek where everyone beams down that's important and they leave Chekhov. They leave Chekhov at
how
the helm.
I can't hear myself.
And you know he doesn't know what the hell he's doing. He's just filling the seat until Kirk gets back.
All right, wait a minute. Here we go.
You know that one where everyone had to beam down, even like
Sulu? I know how to interview.
At least Sulu knows how to run the ship. When they leave Chekhov there, hey, Captain, I will warm the seat up. That's what I feel like now. I'm looking at Dice in Opie's chair.
We're going to interview this guy. I'll start.
We've talked to him.
All right, so you did the movie with Macaulay Culkin, right?
Mm-hmm. What are you doing, Travolta?
Did you dance the 2001 with him?
Is this Slangini?
This is Slangini.
Or Tony Manero.
Well, I'm trying to make it interesting for the listening viewer.
You're doing a bad job of it.
All right, so you ask him a question. And
I know
answer.
Everything about the guy. Did I you, was just bringing up. I was introducing
you
him.
Gonna do a, all right, so this was Home Alone. Mm-hmm. I was goofing. I seen the movie.
Mm-hmm. Ah, see?
That's, so that's where they go back into the future with Shaky Drawers, whatever his name is.
Michael J. Fox.
Yeah.
No, it's not. That's not Home Alone.
Do you believe how they parade this guy around now?
Well, he's got a cause now.
No, but you know what? I happen to be a big Michael J. Fox fan.
Right.
You know.
Oh, you've seen any of his movies?
I was a big fan of the Family Game.
Family you know, Ties.
Yeah, when he would be on there with that blonde, oh.
What, you liked the mother?
Oh.
You liked the mother in there?
Yeah, what? Who wouldn't?
Right.
Why do you think they picked her? They're going, she's slobby enough that she's a turn-on, but yet she's nice enough that she might be somebody's mother.
Right.
You know what I mean?
So you enjoyed
so
that.
I tuned in. You know, and I'm like looking at it going,
when you were first attracted to Michael J. Fox.
Yeah, and then I saw them together.
Yeah.
And you were
back
Biff.
Back to the Alone.
He was not Biff in Back to the Future.
And he's going like this. He's knocking on his head, McFly.
No.
Wake up, McFly.
No,
McFly.
No. Yeah, that's not him.
All right, so who is it?
He's the guy from...
he was
from
Lumpy.
Home Alone. No, he wasn't Lumpy. Lumpy on what? Leave It to Beaver?
Yeah.
Sometimes he gets mistaken for, the guy from Twister, right?
All right, so forget them.
Brad Pitt.
Brad Pitt?
A little bit of Brad Pitt. I see a little Robert Goulet.
Yeah.
Him opening his mouth. Where do I see him?
Dice, we
you know
have...
I mean? Everybody's thinking, oh, Robert Goulet's all over now.
What?
He's the big shot.
What, you like Goulet?
No, I'm saying he wants to start in with all these different guys with Bacharach and Humpdink.
Who?
You know,
who's starting in
Goulet?
Left?
He's all over the news with that friggin' thing.
What's wrong
you
with
know?
Goulet?
And he's like, yeah, Tommy, you got your money, Tommy? You know what I mean? Bring it down to the bar to 600. I'll give you 600. And then I'll just start smacking your face into the table. You know what I mean?
Dice, we got 30 seconds.
I'm not 12
seconds.
Years old no more.
Tell everybody
you know
where you're going to be.
This is the best
interview. I'll be at Westbury tomorrow night.
Westbury tomorrow
night. And then
in the roundy round thing.
The Beacon Theater.
Yeah, the Beacon.
The next night. The theater I went to.
Right.
Back then. When men did things as oysters.
Very good.
Now, come on. People are going to think I'm a moron.
No,
like,
but they know you're a moron. Don't worry.
No, I'm a comedian.
Be, right.
It's a difference.
I understand.
You know what I mean?
The Beacon on Friday. Tomorrow is Westbury Music.
How come you don't get the control panel?
I got the computer. I got the phone screens. I'm set up fine here.
I'm not stepped. You're all set.
Yeah.
You're all set.
Look at what you're doing to poor Ben. We got to go. We're out of time, Dice.
All right. Goodbye. See you tomorrow night,
everybody.
See
you tomorrow. Opie,
God bless.
Thank you for leaving, you bastard. We'll see you tomorrow.